CBC Hockey Night in Canada, brought to you by Molson. Brewers of Molson Export. It keeps on tasting great. Canadian General Electric. Progress for people since 1882. Canadian Tire Dealers, with 326 stores to serve you across Canada. And by the Ford Motor Company of Canada, on behalf of your Ford and Mercury dealers from coast to coast. The New York Islanders are traveling an expressway marked Stanley Cup number 2. And again tonight, the road leads to the Nassau Coliseum. Last year's Stanley Cup celebration was a day to remember for Long Island residents. They're just as eager to celebrate this time as they were the first time. And in game number 1, the Islanders gave every indication that they could win a second consecutive Stanley Cup. Two shorthanded goals and the same major penalty turned the trick. The first by Bryan Trottier from a fine setup. Rookie Billy Carroll making the pass to Trottier. And then Anders Kallur's second goal of the period again, shorthanded. The first time since such records were compiled that two goals have been scored while a team has been killing a major penalty. The Islanders went on to win it by a score of 6-3 for a one-game lead in this series. Good evening, everyone. I'm Dave Hodge. Welcome to game number 2 of the Stanley Cup Final on the Hockey Night in Canada and USA Networks. The big story of tonight's second game from Minnesota's standpoint, the insertion of 19-year-old rookie goaltender Don Beaupre. With me is Coach Don Cherry, who always had an affinity, I think, for the veteran goaltenders. Jerry Cheever's name comes to mind. How do you react to a teenager playing goal in the Stanley Cup Final?
Well, we got to remember that this kid was a sensation for the first half. He was their number one goaltender. I think Milosh has got a little tired. He's played a lot of hockey. He's really, I think he's lost a little enthusiasm. This kid coming in might pep him up a little. I think it's a good move.
Well, of course, Beaupre has played one game in each of the three previous series, and he made an interesting comment. He said he thinks goaltending is still going to be the key to this series. Now, it had very little to do with the first game, and you would think that a rookie would want to deflect any of that pressure. He seems to want it on his shoulders.
Well, I see the remarks he's putting in the papers here. I'm telling you, he's got to have more confidence than any goalie since Cheever. I saw this guy's really got it. He can hardly wait till the game gets started.
Well, we'll be anxious to see how Don Beaupre reacts to his first appearance in a Stanley Cup Final. Now with more thoughts on Minnesota's approach to tonight's second game, here's Gary Dornhofer with Mickey Redmond.
The Minnesota North Stars, a young, inexperienced hockey club, it certainly showed in Game 1. Now, they may improve in that area as far as skating is concerned, but Mickey Redmond, there are other areas that they have to really excel in if they're going to beat this hockey club, the Islanders.
Well, they tried the other night, Gary, to try and carry the puck in. The Islanders were standing up at the blue line and handling them very well. I think tonight we're going to see Minnesota trying to dump the puck in, chase after it. The only time they did it the other night, they got a goal by Ciccarelli, so I think we'll see a lot of that. A lot of pressure on the Islander defenseman.
And I think it's also very important for the North Stars defense to get that puck up as fast as they can. We have one more note that Tim Young, who had minor surgery, will see some action tonight. How effective he will be, we do not know. Probably be used on the power play. And let's now go back to Dave Hodge.
Well, one thing is for certain, the North Stars are the team that must make changes. The Islanders have their path clearly marked. If they can play as they did in Game 1, they're going to be awfully tough to beat. You've met the members of our crew, all but one, and that is play-by-play announcer Bob Cole, standing by to give you the action in tonight's second game. It's the North Stars of the Islanders, and our Stanley Cup coverage will return in just a moment.
There is no question it's been a Cinderella year for the Minnesota North Stars, and it's been so because of their outstanding rookies. Tonight, Glenn Sonmore feels his rookie goaltender Don Beaupre can stop the Islanders. The New Yorkers say, no way, nothing stops us now. Good evening, everyone. I'm Bob Cole with Gary Dornhofer and Mickey Redmond in New York for Game 2 of the Stanley Cup Final. Gentlemen, the fans are starting to chant already. Gary, Mickey, it's hockey atmosphere at its very, very best. It's going to be tough to stop the New York Islanders.
You're absolutely right, Bob, and the noise was unbelievable in Game 1. There's no reason for it to change tonight.
but we had a very hot and humid day here in New York. The ice conditions will not be that good. It will tend to get a little sloppy out there with the pucks bouncing around, and that certainly could be a factor before the game is over.
Well, Gary, the North Stars the other night made a lot of defensive errors in their zone in front of Jill Malosh. The Islanders, of course, the great team that they are, capitalized on those mistakes and put a few behind Malosh. So Minnesota's going to have to be very careful, especially back in their own zone.
The North Stars are on the ice, and here come the Islanders. And listen to this crowd. Again, of course, a sellout here at the Coliseum on Long Island.
Well, yesterday, both teams worked out, the Islanders going through various drills, very sharp in their passing, freewheeling, a very confident hockey club, and it's going to take a heck of an effort by the North Stars if they're going to win a game here in the Island.
You know, a lot of people feel that the North Stars are going to go out in four games straight, but I don't know. Minnesota's definitely going to play better than they did in game one, but I think the big problem, Bob, is going to be how well are the Islanders going to let Minnesota play.
Mickey, you heard Don Cherry and his thoughts on the rookie goaltender, Beaupre. What about yours?
Well, Beaupre, Gary mentioned earlier, a real confident youngster in there. He's played well in the playoffs. He gave up 6 goals in Boston in game 2 of the first series. But he's really got a lot of confidence. He likes to challenge the shooters. Very quick. He's a go-down goaltender.
Gary, what about Tim Young? You played injured.
I know, but Tim Young is playing with a serious knee injury, and, you know, that's going to affect his skating. I sometimes maybe question the decision to go with Tim Young, perhaps give him an extra day, and it would be an extra 3 days rest, but I'm sure Glenn Sonmore will only use him on the power play where he will be a real asset.
Okay, stay with us, folks. Here's game 2 of the Stanley Cup Final. The New York Islanders, defending champions, and the Minnesota North Stars. But first, Joe Duer and the American National Anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. All the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets ran clear, the bombs bursting in air gave proof through the night that our flag was still
tonight. Brian Lewis is the referee, Ray Scapinello and Leon Steckel are the linesmen. Just 19 years old from Kitchener, Ontario. Here he is, Don Beaupre. He starts for Minnesota. This man has won 11 and lost only 2 this playoff year. Billy Smith in the playoffs overall, he's 42-17. How about that? He's tough to beat at any time, but in the playoffs, almost unbeatable. This game is underway, and Beaupre gets a chance to move it back to the net. The North Stars starting away. Pass went from Anderson off his skate. In the center ice area, Hartsburg couldn't clear it in. Merrick flipped it over for Nystrom. That's that good checking line. Or New York, it's in back of the net. Tonelli was knocked down and couldn't center it. He got it again, gets it back in front. They cover up, though. Nystrom, forechecking, keeping it in. Finally, the Stars bring it out. MacAdam comes through center, across the line. He dropped it, look out. Potvin ran into his man and sent him sprawling. Now just outside that line, it's cleared back in, and the Islanders are now changing as the play goes into the Minnesota zone. The North Stars come back. This is McCarthy. McCarthy shoots it in on the boards. Here's Bobby Smith. He left it there. McCarthy again centered it. Well, the Islanders cover up. Long on the right side. That's Kallur coming in. Rolled it in front. It just missed Gillies. He was cruising in looking for the pass. It hit him and bounced behind him. Goring can't hang on to it. Ciccarelli is dumped. They're roughing it up in this first minute and a half of the first period. And a penalty coming up against New York. This is Bobby Smith shooting. And there's Billy Smith making a big save and hanging on to it from Long Island. This is Stanley Cup 81.
Now, from EverReady, the Energizer.
We took the Energizer test. Amazing. We put premium Energizers in my calculator and regular carbon batteries in the other. And then we started stock taking. The Energizers lasted 6 times longer than our regular batteries.
The Energizer, Energizer for life.
Now, win energy for life. Over 1,000 other prizes. Get full details wherever you buy Energizers.
Islanders Kallur for holding first penalty.
Well, it's so very important for the North Stars to get off in a good start here. It happened in the offensive zone. Kallur on the hold, and Tim Young will make his first appearance in this Stanley Cup Final Series. But you wonder, how effective can this guy be? Minor surgery, very difficult for him. He's only skated a couple days.
McAdam went after it. It comes back near the line. Hartsburg took a shot. Rebound! And it just missed that far corner. Close call to the left of Billy Smith. Pressure on now. The Minnesota North Stars, man advantage. Long shot from the line by Payne, didn't get through. Now he's bumped by Morrow. Morrow couldn't clear it, though. Minnesota looking good now in this power play, but up to this point when it's stolen by Trottier, and he clears it down the ice. Minute and a half left in the penalty. No score. It just joined us. Just past the two-minute mark in the first period. Minnesota, man advantage, two center. This is Bobby Smith. What a great move. And there's going to be another penalty right here. Smith made a fantastic move inside the blue line, drawing a penalty.
Well, one thing we've noticed right off the bat is that the North Stars are skating. That one was a simple matter of drawing a penalty against the Islanders, and Trottier will get the penalty for tripping.
No question about the penalty here. Trottier really put the hook on the Minnesota player going on the left side. If he hadn't, if it would have been a clear-cut breakaway. You see Smith come over, make the little pass, and there comes, I think it's Ciccarelli or Kristoff. I couldn't quite tell on the replay, but the trip, and now a two-man advantage. Boy, what an opportunity. 1:16 still left in the first Islander penalty.
Wow, this is a great chance now for Minnesota. Two-man advantage. Islanders shoot it down the ice.
You know, the first 10, 12 minutes of this game, very, very important for Minnesota. Could be the whole series right here if they can get out to a good start.
The first goal in Stanley Cup play this year has proved to be quite successful. That team usually going on to win the game. Now Minnesota, two-man advantage. That's Ciccarelli in the corner, back of the net. On the other side, Kristoff playing it off the boards, but it's cleared up to center. Look out for Goring. He nearly got through. Back for Bobby Smith. He took a shot. Low shot. The rebound comes right back in front, and Potvin easily clears it down the ice.
Not very good in shot selection by the North Stars. First of all, get it in that zone, then set up. They have that two-man advantage. It should be easy to work a two-on-one against somebody.
Kristoff played it in on the wing for Smith. It comes in front. Billy Smith tried to tip it away. He did. Into the corner again. Minnesota setting up now. Here's Bobby Smith turning around, looking for room. Can't find it. There's the great pass. The shot didn't come off. It's cleared to the line. Maxwell now driving it in. Trying to get a tip in front. That didn't work. Hartsburg over here getting set. One penalty just about over, and it is over now. Islanders one man short. There's a shot. Rebound. They score. Had to happen. You knew it. Ciccarelli, that rookie, what a year he is having. And it's 1-0 Minnesota.
Well, you wondered if the North Stars would ever score. Their shot selection and their passing, very tight out there. But Dino Ciccarelli, watch him to the right of your screen. He'll move in front. Normally, the North Stars don't like to put the guy in there. He just comes in there as the shot is directed, gets his own rebound. You notice that both Islander defensemen are away from Billy Smith, and Ciccarelli is all alone. Nobody picks him up.
Well, Billy Smith didn't have any chance in the play at all. He couldn't see the puck coming through. Two Islander defensemen, a Minnesota player in front of him, and Ciccarelli standing right on his doorstep to pick up the rebound.
Number 13 for Dino Ciccarelli.
The assist to number four, Craig Hartsburg, and number 28, Steve Kristoff. The time of the goal, 3:38.
3:38, the time of that first goal in this game of the North Stars on a power play, 1-0. Mickey.
As I look at Sonmore, he's got to be a little bit happier now to get that first goal in the hockey game. Got a good start, but you know, very important. That first penalty of the Islanders was just up by a couple of seconds, and the goal being scored, of course, wipes out the second Islander penalty, so now five aside again.
Hartsburg and Kristoff got assists on the goal. Ciccarelli is 13th. Trottier shoots it in for New York on the net. Beaupre stopped it. Easy save. On the blue line, it's kept there in back of the net. Trottier trapped it, knocked it down beautifully. Tried to center it, couldn't. That's Bourne. He's put on the boards, and there's a penalty coming up against Minnesota. Bourne drawing this penalty. Tonight's Stanley Cup playoff game is coming to you from Long Island.
This is the Electromulch lawnmower from Canadian General Electric, and it does a great disappearing act. Watch. The Electromulch cuts and recuts its clippings into a fine mulch and then blows it down out of sight, where it becomes fertilizer. The result? One beautiful lawn with no raking, no bagging, no storing or pouring. Ah, and that all adds up
to a few magic moments for yourself. Thanks, CGE.
Another penalty, this time Minnesota. Fred Barrett for holding.
Fred Barrett, the 30-year-old, the only one in the lineup tonight was Jill Melosh, standing by watching. 10-year veteran. It happened actually in the other corner, and so the Islanders will get their first opportunity. And in game one, the power play was not effectual at all.
Bache left it there on the draw. It comes near the line. McEwen fed it in. There's a shot. Beaupre makes his first stop. That you'd call a good shot from about 30 feet. Put it right on the net, and Beaupre covered on the angle.
Boy, he's fired up down there, too. You see him slap the goalpost with a stick. He gets the first big shot, makes the save. Very important for him, Gary, being the youngster that he is, to get those first couple of stops, if possible. He hopes to make them anyway and get his confidence up.
Minute and 53 left in the penalty. It just started. It comes back to McEwen again, sliding it into Bourne. Bourne taking a look. Minnesota setting up the box, trying to defend against this Islander power play. And Gary, that is not easy.
It certainly is. And when you have the likes of Trottier and Bossy out there, Trottier, he'll set up a lot of plays, works from behind the net a lot. Now, we have to watch Beaupre. He has an excellent glove hand, and a lot of times he'll give the shooters more area on the glove side and then just take it away as the shot originates.
Back of the net goes Maxwell. Puckman will stop it at the blue line. McEwen has it now. Into Bossy. Scores! You can't let that young man have room like that. Bossy in the slot. Beautiful. He took one look.
Scoreboard in game one, but that doesn't happen very often. Watch the slot area. That perfect pass. But what makes this goal possible is it hits Bossy's stick and then it's gone.
Well, you talk about a trigger. Does he unload that one? Top into the left-hand corner over Beaupre's glove, and he hasn't got the puck a split second, and boom, he lets it go. Watch this. He gets the puck in the slot. There he is. Bingo. Right up high. Boy, that's a real gun, Bob.
Tell you, that young man can shoot a puck like, oh, I don't know. Mickey, he's got to be one of the best you've ever seen.
No question about it. You noticed how well he got into position, Gary, the other day. We were talking about that slot area, eh? And that's exactly where he got in position to take that good shot. Nobody around to cover it.
A lot of players would have taken more time, probably wouldn't even got the shot away, but that isn't the case with Mike Bossy.
4:33, the time of the goal. It's tied now at one. And here come the Islanders again. Good move right in front of the net by Roberts to clear it. Coming down is McAdam. He's bumped inside the line along the boards. Now they're roughing it up down there. There's going to be another penalty, and I think the New York Islanders come up with this one. This is Hockey Night in Canada from Long Island.
You're moving, moving, seeing the last of spaces. Say goodbye to familiar faces.
It's never easy to leave your home, but Allied Van Lines promises to manage your move expertly and care for your possessions as though they were our own. We're the careful movers.
Allied, Allied. will see you through.
There's Langevin. Islanders penalty holding.
Again, referee Bryan Lewis is calling it very close to the vest. Langevin against McEwen, or against MacAdam along the boards. No doubt about the call. So the North Stars will get their third opportunity on the power play.
Tim Young, number 17 now, his first time in quite a while for Minnesota. Let's see how he does. Last scoring play was Bossy. Power play goal from McEwen and Potvin. 4:33. Ciccarelli, the Minnesota goal from Hartford and Kristoff at 3:38. 1-1 tie. Potvin coming out in front of the net, nearly lost it there. We're getting more penalties. I think we'll get double minors now. And it'll be Morrow of New York will go.
Well, this is really going to hurt the Islanders of Minnesota now. With a 4-on-3 advantage, Morrow for the Islanders. Steve Payne for Minnesota, MacAdam for Minnesota going to the box.
They cancel, I believe.
Just the one penalty. 25.
Well, they both get penalties, but Mickey, that's that rule where you don't go down to that 4-on-3 situation that was changed this year. And, you know, that's what teams like to do. They don't mind taking a double because then the 4-on-3 certainly is to the power play team.
The only time it can happen is when, of course, you get the double minors first and then an infraction against one
single
team or the
later,
other.
Yes.
Okay, so it's minor penalties. Morrow of New York. And MacAdam, of course, of Minnesota. Cleared down the ice. That's Beaupre. Out of the net, tipped it back to the goal. Archberg turning against Goring. At Butch Goring. Something like 40 stitches. They put in his lip the other night after the game. He got a bad cut. Didn't stop him for very long. He was back into the action. Quick repair job, but of course after the game they got down to proper business, I guess. And did it up in fine style. 40 stitches, fine. Off the boards, it's hammered out across the line, not across the line, kept in front by Maxwell. Right in front of the net it comes. Minnesota couldn't hang on to it. Hartsburg just coming up near the line, couldn't keep it in. Now he's in with it. Passes off in front, it's hammered down the ice again. 50 seconds left in Langevin's penalty. That's the important one now, giving Minnesota this man advantage. The score is tied at one. This is Maxwell shooting one in. Hustling back is Gordy Lane. Picks the opening easily and shoots it away.
Well, the North Stars shoot the puck in, but then there isn't anybody arriving. And again, very sloppy play on part of the North Stars in this power play.
Ciccarelli coming across the line, and again, broken up by Trottier. Man falls, and Trottier goes in, and he gave it to him. Giles got back up, and Trottier flipped the pass over, and there he was. So Giles skates across center to clear it in. Trottier comes all the way back, flipped it into the corner. Lane can't catch up to it. Giles and Lane will bump into the corner again. That's Bobby Smith getting it back to Giles. On the other side it goes. Big shot. Now Robert shooting. Knocked down by Billy Smith and cleared down the ice. And they're even now. Langevin's penalty is over, so icing is called against New York. It's tied at one.
Billy Smith, a good job defending the Minnesota power play, but you know, in that situation with the two penalties last year, a lot of times a team with a man advantage would go out there in front of the net, and we look at a replay of some of the Minnesota chances and try to take one of the players off. You see, Smith took that shot right on the top of the knee over top of the pad.
But you noticed on that play, nobody in front of the net. The North Stars had a man to the side, but I still think you have to get in front of Billy Smith, try for that deflection.
Mickey, I know you wanted to get that thought out. You'd send somebody out to take somebody off.
To take a guy off with them and therefore give you that 4-on-3 situation, but I guess I'll have to get an up-to-date rule.
Here's the pass to center. Cleared back in by Palmer. McEwen goes back, and it's offside. Will it score? Islanders 1, North Stars 1. This is Stanley Cup 81.
Get away, get away, get away.
Introducing a new front-wheel drive two-seater sport coupe, 1982 Ford EXP, the getaway car. It puts fun back into driving again. With automatic or four on the floor, front-wheel drive, full instrumentation, four-wheel independent suspension, surprising fuel efficiency, and rack and pinion steering. 1982 Ford EXP, the getaway car.
Bob Cole with Gary Dornhofer and Mickey Redmond, Long Island, New York. And this is action of game two of the Stanley Cup Final. The Islanders lead the series, winning two nights to go. It's 1-1 now.
Bryan Lewis has just said something to Freddie Barrett, and I'm sure it said something to the effect that Glenn Sommer, you better watch what you say to the officials, because Freddie Barrett went over and is talking to Glenn Sommer right now, and he just put his arms in the air to the effect of, what are you talking about?
Here's the play coming down on the left side. Barrett goes in back of the net. Waiting now. Coming out with Broughton to his right. He goes the other way with it. Up to center is Smith. He is stopped. And Barrett has to come back again. 12:24 left in this first period. Bomber's pass going astray near center. The two defensemen standing right up there near the center ice red line. And McEwen picked it off and cleared it in. Barrett left it. Broughton over in the corner. Barrett trying to help. McEwen stopped him. Back of the net it goes. Into this corner. Now Palmer comes up with it. He was bumped by Gillies. The shot is deflected away from Beaupre. And players are flying everywhere now. Carrying on down that side is Smith. Long shot. Stopped by Billy Smith of New York. Look out. Look at them line each other up now. They're looking each other square in the eyes. Palmer left it. Carroll nearly stole it. Barrett again starting out. Flipped a high one. It goes down inside the New York line. And McEwen touching it. It's icing called against Minnesota. Mickey, they're really looking at each other and lining each other up, and it's getting rather heavy out there.
Well, Minnesota has to do this to stay with the Island team. The Islanders, a good skating hockey club, but they can hit as well. They've got a lot of big boys out there. But Minnesota can throw their weight around when they want to. They didn't in game one, and they felt they had to do it a little more tonight to be effective against the Islanders.
Soft coming up to the right of Beaupre. Tonelli to the left. Merrick at center. Nystrom on the right side for New York. Anderson couldn't get the draw. Quick shot. Now it comes off McAdam. Out across the line is Payne. Coming in with Anderson. Billy Smith out of the net to stop it behind the goal. Tonelli will try to clear it. He does. A two-on-one coming. This is Merrick and Nystrom in the clear. The pass to Nystrom. He nearly poked it in. Couldn't make contact. He was too well covered. Payne went behind the net, but Nystrom beat him to it. Centered it. Now Payne from the corner. Tried to get a pass away. Ran into Tonelli. Tonelli boots it ahead for Nystrom. Nystrom, a good move back of the net. Taking a look now. Nystrom's pass comes out into the slot area. And Payne breaks away. Coming down with McAdam on the right wing. He stops. He's offside. It's called that.
Now Steve Payne really made a good play to get back and cover up on Bob Nystrom. As a two-on-one break by the Islanders, but Steve Payne is really suffering from a swollen hip. Got that in game number one. Having a lot of difficulty skating, but what a second effort to break that pass up to Bobby Nystrom.
Now Payne, the leading goal scorer in the Minnesota club with 13. Well, now Ciccarelli, I guess, with 13 as well. Tied for the goal-scoring lead on the North Stars, but been quite a hockey player in these playoffs.
They played 9 minutes and 15 seconds of the first period. The score is tied at 1. Back there is Gordy Lane for New York. Trottier dancing to this left side. Pass goes to Lorimer up across the line at center. Bourne didn't see it. Went behind him off the boards, and here's Giles. And he touches it, and it's called icing against New York. Gary, you gotta say that Minnesota looks improved at least 80% in the first 10 minutes of this one.
Well, I would say in their own zone, they certainly have improved. They're taking the man out very effectively, but Sonmore had stated that it's important for the wingers to interfere with the Islanders just for a few seconds to allow our defensemen to get turned around and see what's coming at them. If we're willing to do that, then we can come out of our own zone. But also, he said, our wingers have to get back and help out our defense.
Lorimer flipped it into the corner. It's cleared out to the line. Here's Bourne getting started. He shoots one in. Coming in is Bossy looking for it. He has scored the goal for New York. There's a drive from the blue line by Lorimer. It was deflected away, and it's called again. 10-10 remaining in this opening period. Different hockey game tonight.
We had talked about the adjustment that the North Stars have to make in dumping the puck in a lot more. That isn't Bobby Smith's style. He likes to hang on to it, make those plays, but of course he hasn't been able to do that against this Islanders Hockey Club. They know it, and I think it's important that Bobby Smith has to make that adjustment.
Well, he does, Gary, and also the North Stars only going with three lines tonight. Sonmore's been going with four lines throughout the playoffs, but Smith tonight will only center one line instead of two, as he normally has been.
Trying to get loose for a shot, doesn't come. Langevin cleared it out to Goring. There's Goring muscling in, dropped it back near the line where Gillies was waiting. Comes to Langevin. Whistle goes.
There's going to be some screaming with that call. The puck didn't seem to come out over the blue line. Of course, it has to come all the way out over the line once it's inside to be called offside. And it didn't look like from our position that puck came fully out over the line, Gary.
It was a very fast whistle by Leon Stickel, and I guess he would have the best position to see it, but we are sitting right over top of the blue line,
and I think we have as good a shot at it as Leon does.
Well, you're not going to ask me to call that one. I'm right across from that line. No way, Gary. Thanks.
Plus, we got a monitor here, too, if we can take a second look.
Billy Smith stopped that long shot. Gillies near the line, trying to move it out. The muscle works. He gets it out across the line. Barrett back for Minnesota. Look out. Gillies bumped him as he passed it in. McEwen circling the net. Broughton tried to hook it away and could not. Kallur played it down to center ice. Gillies didn't see it in time, and it's flipped back where McEwen has to cover up. McEwen for New York. Into the corner. Score tied at one. And here's Goring coming out again. Up at center. Goring over across the line. Goring still has it. Look at it go. There's Goring centering it. Langevin. And it was kept by Gillies wide. But boy, what a rush by Goring. Here's Goring looking for it again. Langevin ran into his man. And yes, sir, he's going for elbowing. Langevin got the elbow up, and he's gone for two. Hockey Night in Canada will continue in a moment. This time for elbowing.
Well, the Islanders are being overly aggressive, and if we can reflect back to Game 7, Calgary and Philadelphia. Philadelphia took a lot of penalties. Calgary did all the scoring on the power play. This could happen tonight.
There's Payne coming in. A pass back to the line. It bounced away from Hartsburg. Maxwell back for it. Payne again will bring it in. Now he shoots it off the boards. Back of the net, Billy Smith stopped it for Denis Potvin. He played it ahead for Trottier, who missed it. Shot into the corner, Young went after it, cleared across the line, and Maxwell waits. Hartsburg to Maxwell, back to Hartsburg, up to center ice, Minnesota man advantage. Stopped at the line, standing right up there was Ken Morrow. McAdam, he got away from a check thrown by Putman. Maxwell gets in position, backhand shot right in front. Oh, they just missed that short side. There's Billy Smith going down. He grabs it, hangs on to it, sticks go high. Little pushing and shoving as they try to protect the goaltender, who is still down on all fours. And he has that puck. And they get him apart.
Get him and Buttman doing a little shoving in front of Billy Smith. You notice on the power play, every time Minnesota tries to carry the puck in, they're being stood up at the blue line. They've got to keep dumping the puck in. When they've done it, they've been effective. And causing the Islander defenseman to make some mistakes. Here's a look at some of that action around Smith.
MacAdam just fumbled that one a little bit.
There you see that Potvin and MacAdam come together there.
But you know, Mickey, on that power play, when the North Stars are coming to their own zone, you know, once they hit that center ice, have the wingers just put that burst of speed on, and that center iceman fired in that corner, you know, so Billy Smith can't handle it. You don't want to shoot it at him. You want to just lob it in the corner. And I'm sure the North Stars, they have enough speed. They should be able to arrive and make contact to come up with that puck.
Well, they can, and they're skating a lot better than they did in game one here tonight.
A minute and 11 seconds left in the Langevin penalty. The score is tied at one. Minnesota, man advantage. In front it comes to Bobby Smith. He tried to set it up for Ciccarelli. Couldn't. And it's cleared down the ice by New York.
Well, we've talked how bad the ice is, and the puck is really bouncing around. Some crazy bounces. So all the more reason that when you're in that scoring position, let the shot go.
Here's Bobby Smith dropping it back. And Giles carries on to center. Cleared in by Roberts. Off the boards, Denis Potvin. He'll find the opening, no question. He's a solid, solid defenseman back there.
That time, the North Stars were standing still at the blue line. The puck was shot in. No chance of getting that puck in the corner when that happens.
Bobby Smith coming out again and dropping it to Giles. Same twosome. And Giles shoots it in. Same play. And it's cleared on the boards, but not out. Minnesota, power play, mind you. They try to get it going in front, but there's no room there. Islanders covering up. Ciccarelli falls, gets it back to the line. Big shot from there. Bobby Smith to Barrett. Shooting! Scramble! And Billy Smith is there again. Only 2 seconds now left in the penalty to Langevin. And now we're getting a little pushing and shoving.
But Gordy Lane stuck his stick right up near Ciccarelli's face. You can see that he's very upset. Gordy Roberts came in from the blue line and give Lane a little shot, but Ciccarelli very upset that Lane put the stick almost in his face just as Billy Smith jumped in a puck.
It's getting a little nasty out there. A lot of bodies floating around. Let's have a look at Lane now and Ciccarelli.
See, right as the play is over, oh, they're going to go down to Smith. But as Lane and Ciccarelli were standing right behind the net, of course, Ciccarelli getting the first goal in the same type of play, picking up the rebound around the front of Billy Smith.
Just some pushing and shoving, no penalties. 2 seconds left in the New York penalty to Langevin. 7:01 left in this period. The first, it's 1-1. Minnesota scored first, then Bossy of the Islanders. There's a shot deflected down the ice, and the penalty is over now. Back quickly was Greg Smith at the blue line. McCarthy turning around for Minnesota. He missed Palmer with the shot. And it goes right to Billy Smith. Lane turning for New York. Feeds it ahead to the line. Coming out on this side, Gillies. He tipped it ahead. Barron picked it off inside his own line for Minnesota. They shoot it down the ice. There'll be call for icing this time. With Gordy Lane back to touch it at it. Icing. It comes all the way back to the Minnesota zone. Live from Long Island, the Stanley Cup playoffs.
There's a company here in Canada that makes an amazing product for your car's engine. It can improve your car's fuel efficiency, give you quicker starts, even help your car run better. And the cost of four is about the same as the price of an oil change. A revolutionary new device? No. It's a fresh set of Champion spark plugs. Think about it next time you're at the pumps. Champions can make a difference. Champion, the world's number one seller.
Glenn Sonmore, even when things are going bad, he always has a thought for humor. He said after game one, for practice the next day, we had such an old bus, we had to push it. Now, is that a way to treat a team that just lost the first game? Things go bad, they really go bad.
And he's still pushing. So far, he's got him in a tie. There's his shot from the line, a rebound, look out! Beaupre, a little bit fortunate on that play. He tried to clear it, missed it, it came flying back in front of him. Lucky nobody with a white shirt could get a stick near it. And it came right to him. He was on his back.
You know, Gary, Sonmore, we're talking to Don Cherry before the hockey game about Sonmore, and he said, you know, he's one of the few guys that I know in coaching that seems to enjoy it. He just relaxes. It doesn't seem to, the pressure doesn't bother him. As you mentioned, he's always funning with everybody and seems to really have a good time out there.
Can I qualify that, maybe correctly or incorrectly? pressure doesn't appear to bother him, maybe. But you're right, he's a happy man. Whoa, Merrick was belted by Bourne, and he is slow getting up. Islanders now, Bossy trying to center it. Now it's called. I'll tell you, Merrick took one heck of a shot from Bourne, and he has been hurt, but you know, he's all hurt. He did get up, tried to get into the play, and then stumbled when the whistle sounded.
That was a tremendous hit by Bobby Bourne, and normally it's Barrett, the guy that's doing the hitting. He was the most consistent hitter in game one.
What's the shoulder?
Just the shoulder.
The shoulder into him. Boy, oh boy.
And down you go. And that'll either hurt you or wake you up. I don't know which is worse.
Barrett already playing with a cast on his index finger. He's got a broken finger. He's got a small cast on it. Going to make it awful difficult for him to shoot the puck.
Amazing, just like a boxer, stumbling to his knees, got to his feet, realized that his team was in trouble and tried to get in there to help a little more. And the referee, Bryan Lewis, was very alert. I think he noticed that Barrett was injured, and he sounded the whistle. And then he fell. 1-1 tie, 5:55 left in the first period, game two of the Stanley Cup Final. Merrick, Tonelli, Nystrom. The draw, MacAdam takes Tonelli out of the play. Maxwell for Hartsburg on the other side. Hartsburg played it ahead, Nystrom is there, intercepting, here's Tonelli. Oh, what a great save by Beaupre on that backhander by Tonelli. Beautiful stop. Anderson got away from one check, then another, and lost it.
Beaupre certainly showed his quickness on that play, but you know, an interesting observation by Glenn Sommer. He says when our defenseman has the puck in his own zone, it's very imperative that the four remaining players create an opening for that man, get themselves in the clear so that guy has someone to pass it to. That's the only way we're going to come out against the Islanders if that happens.
Morrow shoots it in. Here comes Tonelli. Tonelli from the corner. He was bumped. That shook him a little bit. Still fighting along with Merrick. Nystrom comes to help. He scores! Nystrom just came in, grabbed it, and rifle it home. 2-1, New York.
Well, we talked about the trigger on Bossy. Bobby Nystrom really let that one go. Watch Beaupre on this play. He doesn't even leave the crease. He's still standing dead still, and Nystrom just fired it right across the front of the net up in the top corner.
It's amazing how Bob Nystrom gets his act together during the playoffs. But I talked to a few of his teammates, and they said for some reason, Nystrom is very uptight during the regular season. He's so concerned about scoring over 20 goals that he's very tight in his play because of that. But as soon as the playoffs start, he forgets about scoring goals, and suddenly he finds the mark.
Well, I'll tell you, he's really got a flair for the dramatic. Big goals last year, the Stanley Cup winner in against Philadelphia, but boy, he can shoot that puck.
But again, it's the forechecking out there, the good forechecking by that line.
For sure, I think that whole thing was set up. The three Islander forwards were down in the left corner, hitting and forechecking and bugging the Minnesota defenseman. Finally, the puck came loose, and Nystrom jumped on it. Holy mackerel, Beaupre still hasn't seen it, right by the front of him.
That line has been very effective in game one and also here again tonight.
The scoring play was Bobby Nystrom, his fifth, from Merrick and Tonelli at 14:39. That's the go-ahead goal for New York. 2-1, Ciccarelli. Stopped by Lane, but Giles is there for Minnesota. Giles coming out. The pass to the left side for Carlson didn't work. Look out, here's Gillies! And he couldn't get the backhander away. Giles was covering up. Centered through everybody. Down the ice for Clark Gillies. Was cruising in there, and he just nearly had another one for New York. Here's Gillies. Bit of skate this time. And Gordy Roberts tipped it ahead for Carlson. He tried to play it across the line. It's stopped by Sutter. Coming back in with Goring. Minnesota lost it. That's Sutter to Goring. Inside the line, and Ciccarelli slapped it from center ice. There goes Bourne. He's bumped on the boards. Lane tries to bring it up. A pass, a good one to Sutter. Knocking it down and going in. No room in there for Sutter. And Minnesota with 4:05 left in the period. Led by Ciccarelli. He missed the pass. Trottier dropped it back to Langevin. To McEwen. McEwen coming to Bourne. The pass to Trottier. He shoots it in for New York. Here comes Bourne. And Bossy is in there too. There's Bossy centering it. Trottier makes a swing at it. Bossy! And he didn't quite get good wood on it. But it went flying in the air, grabbed by Beaupre. This Stanley Cup playoff game is coming to you from Long Island.
With everything Canadian Tire sells, you might think our name should be Canadian Auto Parts. And fishing. Sporting goods. And camping. And plumbing. And houseware. And home improvement. And hardware. But you can call us Canadian Tire for short. There's a lot more to Canadian Tire than tires.
Play just underway. It was cleared to the Islanders' line. They come back down with it again. McEwen trying to set up Trottier. Langevin at his own blue line for the Islanders. He ran into some difficulty. Couldn't move it out. Now it's Barrett dumping a high one in. It's to the right of the net where McEwen slapped it over for Tonelli. Coming down with his long pass going into the zone. It'll be icing. If Kristoff gets back, he does. And it's icing against New York with 2:59 left in the first period. The Islanders 2 and the North Stars 1. It was Bossy and Nystrom scoring for New York. And for the North Stars, Ciccarelli.
They ask Al Arbour about the Islanders having an easy time of it in game one as we look at Glenn Sonmar continuing to talk to his players. And he said, yes, it wasn't that difficult a game for us, but I expect a big battle ahead of us. The North Stars are a fine hockey club. They showed that in the other series, the underdog, and always kept bouncing back and able to generate an offense. And before it's over, we expect a tough series.
Jim Young is number 17. Comes to center ice for Minnesota. Here he is. McAdam to the right, Payne to the left. Maxwell and Hartsburg, the two defensemen for the North Stars. At Potvin gives it to Nystrom, dumping it to center ice. This is Maxwell, down the right side, shoots it in. Back first is Morrow. Back of the net for Potvin. Potvin's long pass hitting Nystrom neatly into Merrick. Merrick played it into Tonelli. He got away from Maxwell. Tonelli around the net. Maxwell caught up to him, stopped him this time. Nystrom going in. Now Tonelli is back into it. They decide to whistle it dead. Tonelli didn't like that whistle. But Brian Lewis said, no, it's frozen there, and that's it. Let's take a moment and go to Dave Hodge.
In the first intermission, I'll be talking to another of the North Stars' fine rookies, Brad Palmer. We'll have a film look at the history of this Islanders franchise, rags to riches in every way. And this afternoon, Mickey and Gary and Don took to the ice to talk about defensemen standing up, how they do it, and why they do it.
From the blue line, shot cleared wide. Comes out to Potvin, went by him, down the ice. Touched by Morrow, and again icing called against Minnesota.
Look at Kenny Morrow, of course, the U.S. Olympian. Big overtime goal against the Edmonton Oilers. A pretty happy fan down there. Brad Maxwell lost his stick over the boards, and the fan thought he had a souvenir. Along came the policeman and took it away and gave it back to the players.
Yeah, the policeman, he was about 6'8", 250 pounds. And
there goes the stick there. He saw the guy jump up and grab it and showing it to all his friends, and boy, that didn't last long. A minute later, it was gone.
Should have grabbed it and started heading for the exit.
Yeah,
I guess he'd get about 10 or 12 feet. They have quite a bit of security here in this rink. I don't know why. They're a peaceful group down here. Here's Potvash. Scoring! Wow, what a shot by Denis Potvin. Off one pipe. And then the other, and in, and it's 3-1, New York.
Well, a couple of good plays on that goal. First of all, the draw, so very important, but now watch Potvin, all the time he has. He hits for the center of the ice to give him a little more angle. But Beaupre is not screened. It looks like he's way over to the right-hand side. Potvin had a lot of net to shoot at.
He was hugging the right goalpost, and Potvin just blew it right by him. He was screened, I think, for a second, and whether he didn't pick it up in time or not is hard to tell, but boy, Potvin really blew that one by him right off the far goalpost.
17-48, the time of the goal. And Merrick on the faceoff, of course, got the assist. 3-1, New York. And now 1:55 left in the period. Minnesota shooting it down the ice. That'll never work. That's icing again, called against the North Stars. And Mister, I'll tell you, fellas, they got their work cut out for them now. If they go away after the first period down two goals, it makes it that much tougher against this Islander team after the rest and back into the second period.
Well, they've had a much better period of hockey, Bob, than we saw them play in game one. I try to mention how well will the Islanders let Minnesota play, meaning they may be able to play better. But, Gary, I was going to say, Potvin, a great shot on the goal, but it shows you the importance of that darn faceoff down there. Merrick won it cleanly.
Yeah, Minnesota has brought their level up, but so have the Islanders, it seems.
Gillies stopped that pass. Enough for Lane to play it back to the Minnesota blue line. Ciccarelli left it there for Giles. Giles to Roberts, to Giles again. He spins this way from Goring, but can he get away from the pesky Goring? Goring chasing Ciccarelli. The fans love it. Listen to him. 1:20 left in the period. Roberts backhands it in back with the goal. That's Lane. Bobby Smith couldn't take it from him on the first try. Stays with it and now gets some help from Billy Smith, who holds it against the side of the net. And 1:11 remaining of the period.
Well, Goring, number one star last night, and he gave an example of why. Lots of energy, this young fellow, but you know, he is so very important in the penalty-killing role and has worked with that young rookie, Billy Carroll. Carroll had a real problem going straight at a man coming out of the zone, and Goring talked to him, spent a lot of time, and said, you got to go at him at an angle. That's the way you forecheck killing a penalty, and they have become a dynamic duo out there.
There's the stop by Billy Smith. The rebound was right there, but nobody could poke it home.
Last minute of the play in the period.
A minute left in this period. Bossy backhands it in. They're offside, and it's called with 55 seconds remaining on the clock. Ciccarelli for Minnesota opening the scoring, 3:38. Then Bossy at 4:33. They're both power play goals. Nystrom, the go-ahead goal at 14:39, and Potvin 17:48 with that bullet shot from the blue line off the goal post and in. 3-1. Islanders on top. 55 seconds left. Trottier, Bourne, and Bossy. Langevin from center to Bourne. Bourne missed it as he tried to stick handle it around Barrett. Now Barrett and Bourne push and shot. Bourne dropped the stick and the gloves. Ryan Lewis was standing right there. Let's see who'll get the penalties now.
I think both of them, Bob.
It looks that way, and Barrett doesn't like that much. Barrett says, what? What did I do?
He may have an argument there because he was just trying to knock Bourne off the puck, and then Bourne dropped his stick and gloves.
Well, here's a look at it here. They were both pushing Minnesota and shoving. Barrett, of course, upset at the check that Bourne threw into him earlier in the period and knocked the wind out of him. Neither one of them really did anything serious, and Barrett going the other way when Bourne dropped the stick.
Well, they were muscling around and pushing and shoving, so they both go roughing penalties at 19:15.
Well, the difference in this first period, I think, is the Islander forwards. They're much more aggressive than the North Stars, and they're with the likes of the big tree there, Gillies. How'd you like to get hit by him five or six times a game? And what a difference from last year and this year. He used to let the guy sleep, and he wouldn't really play aggressively. From game one, he has hit everything that moved.
Merrick to Potvin at the New York line. Merrick flipped it back inside the line for Morrow to Potvin. To Morrow, 34 seconds left. Nystrom sprung loose. On the right side, he's in across the line with Merrick. Oh, and the backhander just wide as he went for the far corner. Minnesota clearing it down the ice again. 20 seconds left. That's Morrow on the boards. And Beaupre will stop it and play it off to the left side for Maxwell with 15 seconds left in the period. This is Hartsburg. coming out to the line. Might get a chance for a shot. It'll be from center. If he does, he didn't shoot it. 3 seconds left in the period. Now he gets another chance, but the horn beats him to it. And the period is over. With the New York Islanders spotting the North Stars, the first goal of the hockey game, and then storming back for three.
Well, I think one of the problems that Lou Lanny was worried about, he wanted his hockey club to skate. They've done that. But as you mentioned, Gary, the Islanders have just turned on the juice a little more, and they're still out here outplaying Minnesota.
And so, the score at the end of the first period is the New York Islanders 3 and the Minnesota North Stars 1.
Ride with the wind and flow like a wave, giving it more than I ever gave. Good times are here for the taking, and now they're rolling your way. Getting away with a friend or two, taking the day to spend it with you. Every minute has some good times in it, and now they're rolling, now they're rolling, now they're rolling your way. There's a good time here for me, nowhere else I'd rather be.
Look out, Canada. You're in for a surprise. Watch. While Ford Fairmont challenges the competition with four-cylinder engine, electronic ignition, rack and pinion steering, McPherson strut suspension, steel-belted radials. And listen, a Ford Fairmont SE with AM radio, power steering, power brakes, electric rear defroster and white walls is priced $1,000 less than a comparably equipped Chevy Citation. Surprise, surprise.
The multi-mode brute, beautiful. In action, a brute. A beauty to handle. A brute that can side discharge, rear bag, mulch, or vacuum your lawn, your choice. And brute enough to have a 3-year limited warranty. The multi-mode brute, 4 beautiful machines in one.
The Islanders fell behind but came back with 3 goals. Bossy in a power play, then Nystrom and Denis Potvin after Dino Ciccarelli had opened the scoring for Minnesota. The Islanders outshot the North Stars 11-9, despite the fact Minnesota had 4 power play opportunities to 1 for the Islanders. With me in the first intermission is Minnesota rookie Brad Palmer, who scored 2 goals in the clinching game against Calgary with shots variously described as rockets and laser beams. You were quite candid about the opening night jitters you had in the first game of the Stanley Cup Final. It must be frustrating to know that tonight you played a better first period, yet really aren't in a very much better position.
I think we're still along the same line of being a little bit jittery out there. I know myself I'm nervous, and I think I'm coming out of it a little bit now, but still I find it very nerve-wracking out there.
As I remember the goals you scored against Calgary, and really in all 3 previous series that Minnesota played, there seemed to be more room for you to shoot the puck, more room for you to skate with the puck. It's noticeable that the Islanders have just cut off that room, and it must be noticeable to you out there.
Well, that's a big thing I was saying to the teammates in that the Islanders really come back on you, and they really forecheck, and they're always back-checking against you, and it seems like you never get that opening that you had against teams like, say, Calgary or Buffalo and Boston.
After carrying the puck so much and making good plays against other teams, tonight it seems that Glenn Sonmore wants you to throw the puck in because the Islanders are not giving you the room at the blue line. Is that a difficult adjustment for you?
Well, it's a different style of game for us. We've been trying to, as soon as you get the puck, skate with it until you see a guy in the opening, but now he wants us to dump it in, which he wants us sort of to forecheck the defenseman because he knows the wingers in the opposite team, like especially I noticed like guys like Bob Nystrom, he's on me all the time, and it seems like it's hard to get away from him, but I think he wants us to force the defenseman more than anything.
Brad, it's been a strange season for you, up and down from Victoria of the Western Junior League, and I wonder whether during all those travels you ever thought that it would all pay off and you'd be in the Stanley Cup Final.
I never thought of it at all. I thought I'd be down in the juniors for sure, so the rest of the season was out. And now that I'm up here, it's still hard to believe what's happening to me right now. I think that's why maybe I have all these jitters. But I think it's slowly losing him. Every shift I seem to get a little more confident, so hopefully in the next period when I go out there, I won't have him.
Was there a time during the season back and forth between the two teams where you really didn't feel a part of either team?
I did. I found it very difficult to adjust to the two teams. I'd be playing in junior one day and back up and playing for Minnesota the next day. And I thought, you know, it's hard to adjust to the style of hockey. And once I did get called up and they told me I'd be here to stay, it took a lot of pressure off me. I think I could have started to adjust to the style of hockey that Minnesota's playing, and it helped me out a lot.
Well, the adjustment is evident, and those two goals are going to live in a lot of people's memories. Certainly, they don't really want to think about them in Calgary. Brad Palmer, our thanks for appearing in the first intermission. Coming up next, we'll have a look back at some lean years for the Islanders, and of course, recently there have been some very good ones. The Islanders' history on film, Hockey Night in Canada, continues in just a moment.
Quaker State helps cars last.
State. It's the best-selling motor oil in North America. Quaker State's the only oil we've ever used in our truck. The way I figure it, when you've got something good going for you, you stay with it. Quaker State helps cars last. And trucks.
A town can die if it ain't got protection. Well, the folks around here wouldn't buy that. So I went ahead and bought my own Rez Wood Stain. Rez protection lasts because Rez grinds its color so fine that it gets right into the wood and sticks there. Buy Rez protection, I said. But they wouldn't listen. And where are they now?
It's a good feeling when you know you've found a bank you can count on.
Checks? I write quite a few checks. Hydro, phone, mortgage, whatever. But my bank statement is like a monthly record. It helps to keep me organized.
Count on the Commerce.
Thanks to our bank, I can bank downtown where I work or cross town where I live. It's called interbranch banking. Great idea.
Count on the Commerce.
Now we make an overdraw and we're covered by a Commerce service called Sufficient Funds.
And that's a good feeling.
Count on the Commerce.
Senior Key accounts like the regular one, but it's free. And I get a yearly bonus on my savings interest rate. Isn't that nice?
Count on the Commerce for the things you need in a bank and more. More branches than any other bank in Canada.
You can count on the Commerce.
The Islanders have experienced another strong first period. They lead by two goals after leading by three in the first period of game one. In less than a decade, the New York Islanders have gone from the worst team in the NHL to the very best. And let's look at some of the things that have happened in between.
Only 45 minutes from Broadway. Think of the changes it brings. For the short time it takes, what a difference it makes in the ways of the people and things.
It's October 1972, and these are the original New York Islanders, fresh-faced and eager for their first season in the National Hockey League. Here, they are playing the Atlanta Flames, the other new team starting play in 72-73. The Islanders are best remembered for that first year because of their futility. Only 12 wins and 30 points in 78 games, embarrassing records which stood until the Washington Capitals came along. But two seasons later, the New York Islanders made the playoffs and made headlines by coming from behind 3-0 in the quarterfinals to defeat Pittsburgh. And here in the semifinals against Philadelphia, they again trailed 3-0, came back to tie the series, but lost Game 7. The following 2 years, they made the semifinals again, losing both times to the eventual Stanley Cup winners, the Montreal Canadiens. From day one, the Islanders' general manager has been Bill Torrey, and he has built a championship team with the likes of Denis Potvin, seen here when he was considered the best junior player in Canada with the Ottawa 67s. The Islanders made Potvin the NHL's number one draft pick in 1973, and he has been the cornerstone of the team ever since. Out west, Islanders scouts spotted a youngster named Bryan, the MVP of the World Junior Tournament in Winnipeg in 1974. After drafting him, the Islanders kept Trottier in the junior ranks in Lethbridge for 1 year before turning him pro. Once in the NHL, he proceeded to set rookie records for assists and points, win the Calder Trophy, obviously an omen of things to come. In 1977, they drafted Mike Bossy a scoring sensation with Laval of the Quebec Junior League. And he's been a scoring sensation in the NHL ever since, with 53 goals his rookie year. Never less than 50 in four seasons. And this year, Bossy equaled Rocket Richard's feat of 50 goals in 50 games. Potvin, Trottier, Bossy, all Calder Trophy winners, and winners of a total of 9 individual awards so far in their sparkling career with the New York Islanders. The New York rivalry between the fairly young Islanders and the old established Rangers is very intense. Islander fans never hesitate to point out that while the Rangers have now gone 41 years without a Stanley Cup, the Al Arbour-coached Islanders won hockey's top team prize last year, their 8th in the league. The Islanders and the Philadelphia Flyers faced off in the 1980 Stanley Cup Finals, and emotions ran high right from the start of Game 1. A strange goal gave the Flyers a 1-0 lead, but before the game was over, Denis Potvin made amends in a big way. In overtime, referee Andy Van Helleman calls a holding penalty on Philadelphia defenseman Jim Watson. And 1 second before the expiration of the penalty, the Islanders' power play pays off. John Tonelli and Bob Nystrom setting up Potvin for the game-winning overtime goal. The Islanders grab the series lead right at the Spectrum with a 4-3 victory. The Islanders' home arena, the Nassau Veterans Memorial Coliseum, has been filled with hockey fans almost from the beginning of the franchise. A few years ago, financial troubles nearly wiped out the team, but perseverance by Bill Torrey and others brought about a change in ownership, and all of those problems seemed far away in the afternoon of May 24th, 1980, the day the New York Islanders won the Stanley Cup. They led the series 3-2, led Game 6, 4-2 into the third period, but the Flyers tied the score, and suddenly the Islanders and their fans experienced pressure such as they had never known before, as Game 6 dramatically went into overtime, a drama that for the Islanders had a happy ending.
Reminders of the importance of the draft as the Islanders built from worst to best, and most other teams in the NHL know the importance of those amateur selections. Coming up next, Mickey, Gary, and Don on the ice talking about defensemen standing at the blue line as we return with the Stanley Cup Finals in just a moment.
St. Andrews isn't just any first hole. It's the first hole. So you don't just choose any long ball. You choose Top Flight or Top Flight XL. The longest balls. From tee to green, no leading ball can beat Top Flight. Maybe that's why over 3 million golfers play the longest ball.
What are you playing? Top Flight? Wish I had.
Top Flight, the longest balls. In 1929, this Niagara generating station was the largest in the world. Generators built in Peterborough by Canadian General Electric and turbines built in Montreal by Dominion Engineering, a CGE company, were part of it. Today's Grand Coulee project in Washington State uses turbines engineered by Dominion and the world's most powerful hydro generators built in Canada by CGE. Progress for people from Canadian General Electric.
Dad, do you think I could borrow the truck tonight?
First, we have to get these fences in.
And if we get the fences in before 6, maybe I could borrow the truck?
Maybe.
Dad?
Yeah?
Nothing.
Well, I reckon that's it till fall. You're too tired to take the truck?
Tired? No way!
So I said to him, Dad, seeing as you're all tuckered out, I think I'll use the truck tonight.
Ford pickups. Daytime workmate. Nighttime playmate.
Getting away with a friend or two. Taking the day to spend with you. Every minute has some good times in it, and now they're rolling away. There's a breakaway kind of beer with a taste that's clean and clear. Molson Canadian, a great Canadian breakaway.
We talked about Denis Potvin and his importance on the Islander power play. Well, that was an area that the North Stars handled really well, probably the only area. But what we're going to talk about tonight is when a defenseman can stand up on the blue line and the importance of that checker coming back with his man. Well, the other night, you know, the Minnesota coaches wanted their team to try and carry the puck in, but because Minnesota, or the, I should say, the Islander defensemen standing up so well, the wingers being covered, they didn't get anywhere all night long. So tonight, I think we're going to see a lot of dumping the puck in, but we're going to do a couple examples here now of maybe how a winger could be covered and is, and in another situation where he isn't covered, and give you an idea what Don as a defenseman might do to try and defense that type of
play.
Well,
you know, you guys, it's all right for me to tell me to stand up, and the coaches say the defense wasn't standing up. If you guys don't do your job, I look like a dummy. You guys have to grab that guy. So let's go run
all
through
right,
a few
give
plays.
It a run.
All right. Now let's assume that the winger's covered on the far side. The centerman's got the puck and he's coming down on me, all right?
All right. Let's I got go. My man, Don. I'm about a stick length away from him. I don't want to get him too far ahead of me. And I'm going to let you know I got him. Okay, let's go, Mick.
All right.
I got him.
I'm standing up now. The centerman, he's coming in. He has to shoot the puck in. That guy, Gary, you pick up the puck because I can't stay. I can't go back, stand up here and go back and get it.
Right. So I, when the puck is dumped in, if that centerman dumps it in, I have to go in and get it.
That's your man.
All right. Now the second example is if I don't have my man, I'm a few strides behind him.
Okay. All right, now let's watch this one. This is a beauty. This is, you're supposed to have him, and I'm supposed to stand up. Now let's see what happens.
Okay, I've got him beat early, Don. Maybe right. Coming out of the zone, I got a pass from my defenseman, and he's been caught forechecking. So now I'm coming down with nobody to defense me but you.
All right, the winger's got the puck again. Let's
right.
go.
Looking for a pass to my centerman.
All right, I'm backing up. I have to back in. I have to back in because he's got the puck. What can I do? There he is. Now he can drop the puck. I don't have a chance. And everybody says, why don't you stand up? That's why you can't stand up.
And what I would do if I'm coming late, I just pick up a point, man.
That's all you can do, and I have to look bad all again.
Defense now the third one. This is a mind-boggler, where you have the guy and you don't have him.
All right, defenseman's all right. nightmare right here.
This is the kind of play now that, as an offensive winger, like I might be looking for a situation when he's coming back all night long and covering me, I might try to figure out a little twist around it. How am I going to beat this situation? And you call it coming late to try and let that winger get ahead of you. And then we'll see what you guys might do to try and counteract that.
All okay, right. Now I'm figuring you got him, and I'm going to stand up, and let's see what happens.
All right, I got him. The guy's probably a little faster, so I feel I have to get up the ice. Next thing, I'm looking around.
All right,
go?
I stand up. There he goes. And the defenseman is blamed again. There's nothing you can do on that. I'm standing flat-footed because I figure you had him. It's your fault that I get in so much trouble.
Well, we saw in game number one where the North Stars had all kinds of problems at the blue line because the Islanders really stood up. So they're going to have to change their game plan and probably dump it in and do a lot better job of forechecking.
Well, Gary, I'll tell you, they'll have to do a lot better in this period because they're down 2 goals as we drop the puck in to start the second. And you know what a lead can do for these New York Islanders. They can either sit on it or worse, they can add to it. Minnesota trying the long shot on Billy Smith. Scoring in the first attention, period, please. Dino Ciccarelli for Minnesota, starting it at 3:38, power play goal, then Bossy a power play goal to tie it. Then Nystrom and Potvin, that shot from the blue line.
Well, after tonight, the teams will have 2 days off. It will resume in Bloomington, Minnesota, Sunday night, and that will be an 8:30 Eastern time start, and the Islanders will be there.
Face off to the right of Billy Smith. 1 minute left in the penalties. There are five aside at the moment. Trottier coming out, getting to the line. He's at center. Up over the line with a shot. Loving that as Beaupre. He was going down as he made the stop up high. We'll watch for that. Maybe the Islanders want to keep that puck up high just in case Beaupre likes to go down as he does so often, but so effectively. That's Merrick dropping into the corner. Hopped away from Morrow. Nystrom covered up in time. Morrow coming out. Played it over for Potvin. He hits the line to center to Nystrom, a good pass. Nystrom faked to go into the corner, then circled, then took the shot. Good save by Beaupre. On the blocker, he just knocked it away. Now Bobby Smith goes back to the net, waits for it in the corner. Then he gets it as he hits the blue line. Down to center, hitting that New York line, turning around, nearly lost it to Goring. Here's a drive, the penalized player is back on. Bobby Smith going back to the net after Lorimer. He cleared it to Nystrom. Not out. Yes, it did come out. Barely over the line. Leon Stickle was right there, and it's offside.
Nystrom with that big goal before. You know, Nystrom shot that puck. I don't believe that Beaupre really saw it. All that scrambling around the side of the net, you really couldn't blame him on the play, but we talked about his goal-scoring feats, and especially in playoff, Gary, in overtime. He's quite a competitor.
Well, he said it's a lot easier to control yourself in your anger emotions the second time around. You experience that the first cup, second time, he feels it's a lot easier. The Islanders are showing that, too.
Lorimer to Lane. Stepped away from Ciccarelli. Pass to Kallur. He slapped at it. Minnesota will bring it back. Bobby Smith from the center ice area finds little room. Circles back. Tipped the pass on the left side, and here comes Hartsburg. Hartsburg couldn't go by Lorimer. Lorimer knocked at it, and it goes to Kallur. Three on one. Kallur going in. Maxwell nearly broke it up. Kallur again! And Beaupre knocked it away from Big Gilly, standing right in front of him. Now the North Stars to center. This is Bobby Smith. Passed it back beautifully. The shot right on. And Billy Smith covered up. Couldn't hang on to it though. It's in back of the net. It comes loose to McCarthy. He was on a difficult angle. Had to hurry it. Couldn't shoot it. Gillies and Bossy coming out. The long shot into the corner. Gillies goes off on a change. The Islanders wholesale changes now. Ciccarelli watched it go by. Didn't catch it. And icing is called against Minnesota. From Long Island, this is Stanley Cup 81.
Preacher, you got a problem.
Well, get off your knees and get on with it, Pilgrim. Wedding starts at 1.
Patience, Preacher. We'll get you to the church on time.
Ah, take a miracle. Well, this is a real professional piece of work.
Uh-huh.
And Midas guarantees it for as long as I own the car.
Uh-huh.
And I still have time to spare, downright miraculous.
Now why so surprised, Preacher? Don't you always take your troubles to the top?
Bob Cole, Gary Dornhofer, and Mickey Redmond. The Coliseum in Long Island, New York. Game 2 of the Stanley Cup Final with the Islanders leading 3-1. 2:29 gone in the second period. Islanders naturally would like to make it 2 in a row here to start the final and take their chances in Minnesota, where the North Stars usually play much better. Langevin, he was bumped. Now Bossy missed the pass. It was picked off in front of him and cleared inside the line along the boards. Bossy goes back with Trottier. Up to center. That's Bourne on the left wing. Here's Bourne cutting in. Right in. He had it roll off his stick before he could shoot it. Trottier to Bourne again. Look out for Bossy. He's right in front. Bossy centered it. Actually, what he tried to do is slap it off the goaltender, Beaupre, I think, and deflect it in.
That's really interesting, Bob, you said that, because it's exactly what he tried to do. That's the sign of a real goal scorer. Into the corner, nowhere to go, and try to bank it off the goalie.
I've seen Trottier score a goal like that before. It's once off the corner, banking into the net. Beaupre had his pads just sitting there. But this is the close call originally. Bourne trying to feed Bossy. Now look at the position that Beaupre is in. It shot it right into his glove.
Almost got it too off the stick of Beaupre. There it is again right there. So always you gotta shoot the puck at the net to score. Bourne's got 68 goals, Bossy.
He's probably the only guy who tries to score from the long walkway for the dressing room out. He thinks goal all the time. Prime example right there, Bossy trying to back it in off the goaltender. But Beaupre saw that from another movie and was alert enough to grab it. Minnesota having difficulty clearing it now. Up on the left wing it comes. They get as far as center. Payne's long shot, no problem for Billy Smith. Now Payne anticipating that move by Smith. Centered it back to Giles. Giles to Roberts. Roberts gets set the shot. They try to tip it in front. Nobody could make contact. And now it's Tonelli coming out with Nystrom and Merrick. That's Tonelli to Nystrom. Look out! Oh, what a great save by Beaupre. Again, shooting out that right hand and blocking it. Nystrom will bring it back in. Nystrom from center shoots it in. Beaupre steps back to the net. The Islanders are changing again. Here come the North Stars. Payne comes down to center ice. Payne's pass a little too far in on the right wing for MacAdam. He went in after it anyway. Roberts goes in to help. They get a whistle for a face-off in the New York zone. Tonight's Stanley Cup playoff game is coming to you from Long Island.
The fishing reel everyone is talking about. The incredible new Zebco Omega 144 Ultralight. A closed face spinning reel perfectly balanced under the rod. The patented straight line drag system so unique, it holds up even under this kind of tackle stress. If you want action, get it with the Zebco Omega 144. New Ultralight addition to the Omega line from Zebco, the folks you fish with.
Islanders 3, the North Stars 1. We're in the second period, nearing the 5-minute mark. As Lane dances across the line, got in a little bit of trouble, but got his pass over, and Trottier slaps it in. Beaupre out of the net, back there to stop it. Goring in forechecking, standing right in the crease area. Play goes by Sutter to center. And there's Lane again. Up it goes to Sutter. And that's offside. We got a moment here, Mickey. We got to thank George Steinbrenner. Oh, buddy, George, as you look at the minor officials down there from Toronto for this series here in New York. Billy McCoy, one of our directors, producer Don Wallace, Mickey, and myself at Yankee Stadium last night. George is pretty good to us,
man. Quite an experience, Bob. It really was.
Oh, Reggie came through with one, but they lost the game.
Not enough.
Lorimer into the corner. That went by Bobby Smith. The long pass to center. Gillies coming in. Across the line, Gillies trying to go in around the defense and was stopped. Now Bobby Smith. A neat pass up this way. Hartsburg drive. Billy Smith, I'll tell you, is alert. Always. What a glove save right there. Pass to Hartsburg. He just knocked it ahead for McCarthy. Bobby Smith, a good move, beating Lane. In across the line, here's a chance for McCarthy. And again, his shot wide. On the other side, the drive was deflected. Smith back of the net, centered it. A went by McCarthy right through his skates. Coming back is Clark Gillies. Gillies driving a long one, and Beaupre stopped it. Sliding out to cut the angle. Nearing the 6-minute mark of the period. Minnesota a little life now. Trying to get closer to New York. They're trailing 3-1. Here's Carroll coming out. Passes off to Lane. Near the center ice red line. It's stolen by Palmer. He's got a great shot. Couldn't get it by the defenseman this time. It was deflected, and Billy Smith covers up.
Well, this second period has certainly been a lot better for the North Stars. They are getting some good chances against Billy Smith. That blast by Hartsburg, we saw Smith make the save with a glove, but he seems to always make the big save at the right time.
And that's what you need, of course, in the playoffs. They say the big goaltending, you're going to have it to win, and that's what Smith has given the Islanders. But Minnesota doing a good job. They got the legs going now in the second period. They're jumping in on top of the Islanders, forcing them to make some bad passes in their own zone, and they are getting some scoring opportunities, as you mentioned, Gary.
Also, Mickey, they're going three abreast. Not only two guys going, one guy way back, but they're coming in there in full stride.
That's the McEwen back of the net to Bourne to Trottier. Bossy trying to get loose on the right side, and Palmer is all over it. Coming in is Bourne. He's making great moves. Bourne centers it. It comes back near the line of drive of Langevin. That's deflected up over the glass into the crowd. But the Islanders pour it out again. That's quite a line out there now. Trottier, Bourne, and Bossy.
Well, Bob Bourne, quite a hockey player. Boy, one of the better skaters in the National Hockey League. Watch a little.
Change
here,
pace.
He stops, keeps going. He's got the defenseman wondering where he's going. He sets up in front. Unfortunately, for the Islanders, they couldn't get it on the net. But a good play by Bobby Bourne.
Bossy is upended. Play goes on. Back of the net. Smith, the pass to the line. Here comes Palmer, sliding it in on the right side. And the drive by Kristoff is blocked by Billy Smith. Coming back out is Mike Bossy. He dropped it. Up to center goes McEwen, hitting the line, dumping it in. Beaupre will hang on to this one. He'll take no chances. This is Hockey Night in Canada from Long Island.
Got heart. Molson Light has got heart. It's got taste. Molson Light has got heart. the movement to life.
There's Mr. Overtime, Bobby Nystrom. He electrified this place last year, almost to the day, give or take a few days.
His teammates say he's the best conditioned athlete in this hockey club.
There he is with the puck now. Bobby Nystrom in back of the net. Look out for Nystrom. Tried to make the play, was deflected back of the goal, and Roberts takes it. Roberts pass harmlessly out to center ice. Here back in by Potvin. That's Roberts in there. Nystrom again. Nystrom centered it. Giles was in front of the net for Minnesota. Down on the right side. Tonelli got back to pick it up for New York, and Nystrom again. Merrick couldn't hang on to the pass. That's Tonelli. Tonelli swings away. Comes back to center. Up over the line is Tonelli. Nystrom goes in to help. Nystrom stops. Good move on the board. Gets it in front of the net. While the North Stars cover up. They try to lead it down for MacAdam. It's too far. Morrow is in. He touches it. And icing is called against Minnesota.
When you look at the likes of Tonelli and Nystrom, the guy that is willing to go in that corner even though he knows he's going to get wrapped by a defenseman, that's what this game is all about. You saw Tonelli, he's willing to do that. Nystrom is willing to do that. And that's why that line has been so effective in this series.
Well, the Islanders and Tonelli, good case in point there with the big guy, 195 pounds, but he can fly out there too, as well as Bobby Bourne and Kallur. They've got speed and size out there in the Islander forwards.
McCarthy gets it along the line to Bobby Smith. Smith tried to bring it in, but he was checked from behind by Carroll. Now Lane comes back. That's McCarthy and Lane. They do not bump. Looked as if they might have the line. That's one shot. And it's called. Lane in behind the goal was upended along with McCarthy. There went sprawling.
You know, Bob, it was a tough night for Craig Hartsburg and Maxwell. They were -4 last night in the game. Both had the pleasure of being on for those two shorthanded goals. But the rebound, you forget about the game before, and you just try to get your act together. And both they were on for the one goal, but played pretty good tonight.
Here's Lorimer at center. Goes up over the line, dropped it to Sutter. Sutter took a shot. Look out. That was a quick shot. And Beaupre didn't see it till the last half second. Then moved very quickly to make the save. Sutter back to the net after Bobby Smith, and Smith is away. Got away from one check. Poked it across the line. But the Islanders back covering up. Gillies for New York shooting it in. Beaupre back to the net to stop it. That's Hartsburg. Stepped away from Sutter. Now gets his pass to Bobby Smith near center. Smith lost it. And behind the play, he cleared a shot in, a weak one, and Billy Smith scooped it up and held on to it. With the score, the New York Islanders 3, the Minnesota North Stars 1. This is Stanley Cup 81.
This dandelion has just been fed easy-to-apply Killex, Canada's leading lawn weed killer. Not only dandelions, but over 50 other varieties of lawn weeds all find Killex irresistible. And like the dandelion, they never live to regret it. If you've got dandelions or any of their weedy friends, get Killex from Green Cross. Killex, lawns love it. Weeds die for it.
The fans here, of course, everybody in the building well aware of the coverage of this series. Hockey Night in Canada, coast to coast, and the USA Network also. Nice to have you all with us for the Stanley Cup Final 81. The Islanders lead the series 1-0 and lead the second game 3-1. They're nearing the 9-minute mark of the second period. I'm Bob Cole with Gary Dornhofer and Mickey Redmond as Beaupre holds one along the ice, the side of the net, face off in the Minnesota zone. Trigger man, Bossy.
Another look at Bossy. Three shots in the first period. Of course, one got behind Beaupre, but well, I tell you, if he gets three, four, five shots in a hockey game, you know he's good for one, maybe two goals.
Bossy slides it back to the line. Langevin shot. It was deflected wide. McEwen sliced one in through the middle. Bossy in the corner fighting for it. He and Trottier looking for it. Now Kallur goes in throwing a check. Center ice area. Langevin again tried to dump it in, but it went too high and over the boards. After the Islanders bench. They'll bring it back near center ice.
All right, we look at Langevin, one of the stalwarts back there. They really like the way he clears the front of the net area from the University of Minnesota. Came here in the expansion draft in 79 from the Edmonton Oilers.
Trottier, Bossy, that's Kallur on the left wing now for New York. Down the left side for Minnesota, Palmer, bullet shot, Palmer! I was about to say give him a second and he'll score for you. And bango, Billy Smith did not move. Can he shoot it, Mickey, or can he shoot?
Oh, what a rip he let go. That reminded you of the goal he scored against Calgary.
Short-handed goal.
Short-handed goal is right. Boy, he just wound up and let it fly on the slap shot. Billy Smith just waved at it with the trapper. Couldn't even get a piece of it. Look at this.
Well, this is the second time that he's had a chance to unload that devastating shot. The first time the Islander defenseman was able to deflect it into the crowd, but he had a lot of room there. Defenseman was well back, time to wind up and let it fly and just overpowered Billy Smith. A big goal for the North Stars.
Broughton, an assist.
Greg Smith.
And Smith, Greg Smith, got an assist. 9:15, the time of that goal, and it's 3-2 now. Minnesota's striking here, thanks to Palmer's bullet shot. And they're close again. Talking to Glenn Sommore about his shot the other morning, and he said, I said, he's not very big, Gary. He's only small compared to most hockey players, but when he walks into the puck like he does right here, he can sizzle it by most goaltenders. And I said to Glenn Sommore, how come he can shoot it so darn hard? And he said, it's just like golf. Now, that's something you know something about. Timing, I guess, is everything. He's shooting this too.
He had the time. That's the Islanders have been closing that area. They haven't been giving the North Stars the time to shoot it. That time, it was there, and Palmer, he made good.
Eddie Westfall told me, besides, you weren't shooting that little white thing too well today. Is that tails at its due? Were you your usual self, or no?
No.
Up the line. Here's Minnesota pressing again. Billy Smith goes down. Tonelli cleared it to Merrick. Not out. Minnesota keep the heat on. But now Tonelli gets it across the line. That's Nystrom. For Denis Potvin. Tonelli on the left wing. Giles ran into him, but Merrick carries on. Penalty coming up. Yes, sir. I think we got a boarding penalty. Hockey Night in Canada will continue in a moment. Tonelli for roughing at 10:26 of the second period.
Well, Tonelli took a piece of Giles. You see them come together on the boards. This allows Merrick to come in and pick up the puck and almost get a two-on-one with Bobby Nystrom, but you see Tonelli kind of roughing up Giles and keeping him out of the play.
This is interesting. Now it's Islanders 3 and the North Stars 2, and Minnesota now has the man advantage.
Well, Bob, it was a scary situation with a score 3-1. Had the Islanders scored to make it 4-1, you'd almost think the game was over, but what a big goal by Palmer, and now they can tie it on the power play.
Giles, Bobby Smith, Roberts, Kristoff, Ciccarelli. That's the quintet for Minnesota. Goring and Carroll, penalty killers. Lorimer and Lane for the Islanders. That's Roberts over the line, shooting it into the corner. That's Lane back of the net. Can he move it out? Nope, not there. It's kept in by Minnesota. Bobby Smith cuts it back of the net. Into the corner, Ciccarelli looking around. Lane watching him. There's Ciccarelli back to the line. Maxwell shot, knocked down by Bobby Smith. Bobby Smith along the boards. Good move to beat Goring. Now Lane watching him. Smith circles. Smith shoots. And it's deflected by Lane. Smith will get a chance again. Bobby Smith working it around now, waiting for somebody to open up. Oh, his low shot is just wide. Kept in, not for long. Lorimer with Goring. One man back. This is Carroll. Goring in front. Goring! And the pass behind him. Gordy Roberts played it ahead. Here's Bobby Smith lumbering in. Up over the line he goes. Dropped it back to Ciccarelli. Look out! Right on! And it's Smith can clear down the ice, but I'll tell you, folks, the Minnesota North Stars are alive now. They have 27 seconds left on that power play. They're trailing by a goal. It's 3-2 New York. And this is Payne coming in. Good play on the far side. Into the corner. Back of the net. It's centered off the boards and down the ice. Out of the net comes Beaupre, and now only 10 seconds left in the penalty. To Tonelli, he's standing up. Minnesota might get one more shot at it. They hurry, they shoot it in. The penalty is over, Tonelli is back on. And it's icing called against Minnesota. Live from Long Island, the Stanley Cup playoffs.
On the one hand, you're sad to see her go, but you couldn't be happier knowing she's found someone that will love her and care for her. In her words, someone just like you. Maybe now's the time to be thinking about your future. Talk it over with a Mutual Life of Canada agent.
Life is a mutual affair.
We understand what you're feeling.
Bob Cole with Gary Dornhofer and Mickey Redmond in the broadcast booth at the Coliseum, Long Island, New York. Game two of the Stanley Cup Final. 3-2 the score in this one. Islanders on top of the North Stars. 7:29 left in the period. And the Islanders. Morrow from the blue line. Dumped it into the corner for Bossy. Bossy is checked back there by Greg Smith. Gets it again. Back near the line. It's picked up by Palmer. Palmer down the boards. He was bumped off the play by Morrow. Greg Smith brings it back in, and it's offside. And call for a face-off at the New York line.
We had a look at Bossy a moment ago, go down and do some good forechecking. He can do other things besides score goals. Made a super play out into the slot area. Unfortunately, none of his teammates were there. One of the Minnesota players picked it up.
From centers, Greg Smith shooting it in. Only Carroll is out playing at center ice now with Bossy and Bourne. And there he is. Carroll to Bourne. Bossy swings to the left side. Bourne stops, takes a look. Where's Bossy? He says, I've got him. Bossy has the puck. Carroll back to the net. That pass intercepted. Bossy is dumped behind the play. The fans hollering for something. But it comes to Palmer at center. Palmer circles. Can't find much room. Got away from Carroll's check. Palmer again. He's got that shot, remember? This time, not a hard one and nowhere near the net. He was on a difficult angle. There's Potvin back to the net. He beat Palmer as he shifted it behind him. Kept in though. Palmer had it slide by him. Back of the net, Morrow. For New York. Morrow's pass to Bossy. Here they come. Bossy coming in. Bossy circles. Spun around. Got the pass to Bourne. Right in. Shot. Another shot. Three shots. Had put it in. Pressure on now. Here's Carroll. Carroll centered it. Bourne was standing there. Comes right back in front of Palmer. Dumped him away down the ice. Have you ever seen anything like that?
Well, that's a good play by Palmer to relieve that pressure. But Beaupre right on the seat of his pants. And the Islanders had four chances. You see the disgust in Bourne. He has his head on the bench. I don't believe it.
Oh, Bourne totally frustrated. He had three or four cracks at it. Just couldn't get the darn thing up over Beaupre. He was down and couldn't get up. Here's where it starts, right here. The first one, the save made.
One.
He gets the rebound again.
Two.
There's the third.
Three. Four went wide.
What are you supposed to do?
Well, I think on the fifth crack, he might have got it in. There is Bob Bourne, very discouraged. Well, maybe that's where a hook stick would have come in handy.
Well, sleep on that one, Bobby. And he will, too. Islanders 3, the North Stars 2. 5:49 left in the second period. My goodness, Bob Bourne. Lift it. Please let it go up high. Oh, no. Please let it go up high.
You talk about cement hands. The North Stars were talking about that after game one. Mike Bossy, he showed that he doesn't have them. Perhaps Bobby Bourne in that case.
Face off. Gillies. Gillies shooting. Not a hard shot and wide. Goring back to the net. Sutter with him. There's Goring. He has it. Usually does. Goring dropped it back to Sutter to the line. Langevin kept it in. And it'll be cleared by Gordy Roberts. He gets it up to the line at center. Bobby Smith missed it. McCarthy bumped with McEwen. Sutter looks for it. Nearly stole it inside the line from Roberts. Gillies kept it in. Hammered one on the boards. Back of the net. That's Roberts from Minnesota. He turns to beat Sutter. 5-10 left in the period. Dropped it back to Giles. Back again for Roberts. Roberts tipped it on the boards. Down inside the New York line. And McKeown is back there with 5 minutes left in the period. On pass to the center ice area. That's Sutter going in. Took his shot. It's deflected by Roberts. In back of the net, Bobby Smith. Merrick took it away from him. Now it's knocked into the corner by Barrett. Minnesota trying to bring it out. Slowly to the line. Dumped down the ice by Roberts. He's looking for a change. Quite a while since they've made a change on that defense, and he just couldn't get off. So he decided to put it in. It's offside. And Barrett goes to the bench with Roberts.
Now, Glenn Sommer had said, I talk to my players, win, lose, or draw. Communication is the name of the game. And a lot of people have asked me about putting Don Beaupre in there. But we felt throughout the season, Beaupre was as very capable a goaltender as was Meloche. So it wasn't that big of a surprise.
Two coaches, Al Arbour there. Previous to that, Glenn Sommer.
Arbour, on the other hand, a very quiet type of coach, Bob.
But he dies a thousand deaths before the game.
Inside, yeah. He just doesn't say a whole lot on the bench. Probably all set between periods.
Merrick, trying to root it free. Nystrom tries to help. They're successful. But it's Minnesota's McAdam flipping it back to the zone net with 4:20 left in the second period. Nystrom knocked it down. Nystrom then couldn't pick it up in time to get a shot. Grabbed quickly by Greg Smith. Smith again to center ice. Here they come. McAdam tries to drive. And he missed the far corner. He had Smith close to the post and trying to go to the far side. Another shot by Smith. And loved by Billy Smith from New York. This Stanley Cup playoff game is coming to you from Long Island.
We know who we are. And we know where we're going. Stars with us every step of the way. We can do what we choose when we're wearing our North Star shoes. We know we can lose when we're wearing our North Star shoes. Cause North Star's with us, we're in step with today.
Bob Cole with Gary Dornhofer and Mickey Redmond. It's 3-2 here in the second period. 3:55 left. Islanders are leading. Nystrom bumped on the boards. Can't move it in. Hitting. Getting prominent again now at this point in the second period. Greg Smith dumps a high one in. Lane is back. Is it icing? No. Minnesota hustling in, they touch it, so they get a face-off now to the left of Billy Smith, and they are hustling now, Dave.
Yes, they are. It's getting a lot better, but a good play by Greg Smith at his own blue line. We talked about standing up in that blue line. You notice how effectively he took out Bob Nystrom. But just prior to that, Mickey, we're talking that two-on-one by Al McAdam. He didn't even look to see if he had a man with him and shot from about 45 feet out.
No, he just decided to take the shot. It was really a good example of a two-on-one. They went in a two-on-one all the way from almost center ice. And he didn't even give the winger a look. He just wound up and let it go and really didn't get a good shot on goal at that.
Brock comes to center for Minnesota. It comes back to the line. Quick shot by Hartsburg, the rebound. Just tucked wide of the net by Ciccarelli. Or make that Kristoff on the right side with Minnesota. Brock at center. Down for New York. That's Bourne again. Bourne back to the net. Center it. Comes back to the line. Bossy couldn't shoot it. Breaking away is Broughton. He might have some room. McEwen chasing him. Broughton trying to beat McEwen. And he spun around and sent flying back to the goal. McEwen still battling on the boards. Trying to move it. Bossy gets a pass out to Bourne. Here comes Trottier through the middle. With Bourne shooting the long one in. Here's Bossy picking it up. Bossy jammed the brakes on. That was not flying in the corner by Hartsburg. Minnesota coming out. Comes through the middle. That's Hartsburg lugging it in. For Palmer, he gets in the slot, spun around. Gillies breaks it up. Down he goes. Gillies all alone. Solo job. Took the shot. And it hit a leg. It bounced right back to him. Gillies set it up in front. Down goes Beaupre. He stops that shot. By Kallur. Again, Gillies. Back of the net. Center it. And again, Kallur couldn't get a shot on the net. Kallur lost his stick. Boots it into the corner. Still fights for possession. Big Gillies got a pass in front. Quick shot by Goring was wide. Great pressure now applied by New York. Minnesota regrouping. Hartsburg brings it to center. The good Russian defenseman played it in on the boards with 2 minutes left in the period. Potvin nearly picked off in front of the net, but here's Goring. Kallur, Gillies catching up. That's Goring stopping. Fed it over in front. Again, Goring poked it in back of the net. Ciccarelli went back. Gave it to Roberts. Minute 40 left in the period. McCarthy on the boards for Bobby Smith. That was broken up by Morrow. And they get a whistle offside at the Minnesota line. Again, Dave Hodge.
Don Cherry is waiting in the coach's corner for the second intermission. We'll also have a feature showing the emergence of women in hockey. Mickey and Gary will look at highlights of the game to this point.
Thank you, David. We look forward to the intermission coming up in 1 minute and 37 seconds.
Well, I admire the North Stars the way they have come out in this second period, and the jitters seem to be vacant right now for the North Stars. They are skating. They're playing with a lot more confidence than they did in game one and even that first period.
Gordy Lane, long shot in. I'll say they are. They're really taking it to New York and staying right with them every inch of the way. In the hitting department, they're breaking in. They're getting good rushes. Pass is looking a little more crisper. And they're causing some trouble inside the New York line. And here it is again with a forechecking. Kane running into his man. But this time, Merrick stopped at the line. He can't move it out. Here's forechecking. Kane taking a shot by Lorimer. Billy Smith stopped it. On the other wing, Tonelli will try to move it out. Tonelli gets his second effort. And the pass behind Nystrom went down the ice. And it's right on the net. Beaupre has to stop it. Kane just at his own line. Nice pass down the right wing. Here come the North Stars. 45 seconds left of the period. Cleared it by Anderson. Tonelli tripped and fell behind the goal. Tonelli got back up. Lorimer trying to hold it, and he does. They get a whistle for a faceoff in the New York zone with only 39 seconds remaining of the period.
Well, I think that last rush coming out of the north side, North Star zone tells a lot. Sonmore had said our wingers have to get back, help out, get in position. They did that. They came out very effectively.
As a result, they're getting a lot more scoring chances as well. They're back in position to be, as we were looking at before after that first period, either coming late and taking the pass like Anderson did on that play. But both clubs really had some good scoring chances in the second period.
You mentioned skating. North Star skating a lot better.
Broughton. At center with Palmer on the wing. They get the draw. Rotten going in. He's only a little fellow. McEwen goes in, hangs on to him there.
They're not very big, Gary, but boy, a lot of guts.
A lot of guts. You know, you talk about skating, and that's how you get your good scoring chances, breaking into those holes. And the only way to stop you sometimes is haul you down. 5-1 the penalties have been so far in this game in favor of North Stars.
Drop the puck in, and Bossy to Bourne. 25 seconds left. Bourne going in, trying to cut around the defense. Almost stopped and out of the net is Beaupre, and he decides to hang on to it with two Islanders in close to him. Trottier and Bossy. 21 seconds left now. Watch this faceoff, folks. We've said this before. My goodness, how many times.
Here's a look at Bourne again, turning the speed on. This time, Fred Barrett gets a piece of him. The fans again hollering for a penalty here. Boy, that Bourne can just fly down on left side. 7-year veteran with the Islanders.
Watch this with Denis Potvin parked at the blue line, just a few feet off for the boards. McEwen on this other side, straight out from Don Beaupre. 21 seconds left. Will it get back to Potvin? Yes, sir. And the shot knocked away by Beaupre. Another shot by Bossy. 12 seconds left. Cleared on the glass by Beaupre. Not out. Minnesota desperately trying to tear it now. Bossy gets in front. Here's Potvin's drive. That was knocked down on a breakaway. Coming down block. Breaking rating on goals. Scores. Hit the goal post. Bounced out. Hit the goal post. Bounced down. The light went on. tell you, the Minnesota players could swear it's a goal, but it isn't. It hit the crossbar, I think. Dropped down. The green light came on.
That's it, Bob.
That's the end of the period.
You know, I think, I don't know if the puck did eventually just turn around, make a curl after it came off the bar and go in.
But we're going to see it again.
The green light did run. You'll have a look at it. As he gets the break, he stopped Potvin's shot. And you'll see him come down. There was only 4 seconds left when he was at center ice. And just as he let it go, you'll see it up underneath the left crossbar right there. The puck hits the bar and comes down. There's the green light is on. The puck is right there.
It did not go over the line.
It did not go over the line anyway.
And so the score at the end of the second period, the Islanders 3 and the North Stars 2.
Presents Color Plus Television, Sanyo's most brilliant color, plus Sanyo's most advanced features, Color Plus.
There's a brand new view in store for you, and Sanyo makes it better.
No matter what we tell you we carry, whenever we say Canadian Tire, you think we've got the biggest names in sporting goods, but when we say Canadian Tire, you think we've got a huge selection of brand name tools and hardware, but we say Canadian Tire and... So now, after seeing all this, when I say Canadian Tire, what do you think? Uh-uh. Now you got it.
There's a lot more to Canadian Tire than tires.
Well, a tough break for the North Stars at the end of the second period. Neil Broughton hitting the crossbar. No time left for Steve Kristoff to put in the rebound. The North Stars continue to trail by one, but they did cut the Islanders' margin in half on the only goal of the period by Brad Palmer. During a recent visit to Philadelphia, Hockey Night in Canada visited with the Flyers' team psychologist, Julie Anthony. Just one example of how women are taking prominent roles in pro hockey. Gordie Howe, he of the energetic elbows, used to make reference to the fact hockey is a man's game. But the women, including Colleen Howe, who guides the off-ice affairs of her husband and hockey-playing sons, are working their way into the hockey field. Take this lady, Laura Stamm. She can boast that she taught power skating to Bobby Nystrom, the man who scored last year's Stanley Cup winning goal. And now let's meet three more ladies who are making their marks in the hockey world.
Hello, I'm Susie Matthew, Public Relations Director for the St. Louis Blues Hockey Club. My prime responsibility is dealing with the media, taking care of their needs and satisfying their questions and what they need to get their job done.
Scoring leaders here with the games last night. You got to take Dunlop out, and with Montreal's game shut, has to go back in. You got 2 points.
Do you have the summaries?
Yeah, they're in
there. It shouldn't be perceived as a glamorous job. It's not by any stretch of the imagination. It's a lot of hard work, envelope stuffing, typing, whatever it takes to get the job done, to build an image for this hockey club.
Hello, I'm Rosanda Scalbani, and I'm president and governor of the New Westminster Bruins Hockey Club.
Rosanda Scalbania's New Westminster Bruins finished a little early this season. Our cameras caught up to her as she followed her father's Calgary Flames and tried to forget the many problems she faced in her first year in the business.
It started off, we had to do a lot of work on our protected player list. And with the other clubs being, or having been building their list for the last 3 or 4 years, there weren't very many top young kids left. Then we had problems with season ticket holders. the last 2 years of the club, they hadn't done too well, and I guess a lot of people got sort of fed up seeing the club lose so many games. And then in January, we were on the road and came back and had no rink to play in because the QP workers were on strike. And so we've been playing our home games in Bellingham, Trail, Nanaimo, Duncan. So it's been a tough year. I stopped, I guess, about 2 weeks ago saying, well, nothing else can go wrong. And that was, we were playing in Bellingham, and we had to stop the game after the first period when the ice machine cracked up the ice and hit cement, so we couldn't play on it anymore. So after that, I've just sort of kept quiet and said, you know, if it'll go wrong, we'll go wrong.
Hi, my name's Mary Flannery, and I'm an NHL hockey writer for the New York Daily News. Covering the Rangers involves a lot of things. I have to go to the games and write a story about the game. Then I go into the locker room and come back up to the press room and write another story, including the quotes that the players have said. I have to go to practices. I have to talk to a lot of people. I have to make sure they're not going to make a trade. There's an awful lot of things involved in covering a hockey team. A lot of people think that the only thing is going to the locker room, probably because it's the most obvious or the thing that sticks out in their minds, and because I'm a woman, that makes it all the more interesting. But I wouldn't have to go into a locker room if male reporters didn't go into a locker room. The only reason why I go into a locker room is so that I can compete on an equal footing with them. If there's a fight in a locker room, if there's a celebration in a locker room, if a player says, I want to be traded tonight, and I'm not in that locker room and I don't hear it, my newspaper doesn't get it, and then my boss wants to know why we don't have it.
And what kind of a reception does Mary get in NHL dressing rooms?
By now, most of the players realize that women are in the locker room to do a job, and I always feel that it's kind of like doctors and nurses and in a hospital. I mean, in a hospital, players don't object when a nurse takes care of them because they know she's doing a job, and I think that they know that I'm doing a job, and that's the only reason why I'm in there.
Okay, these gals are competing in traditionally male-dominated fields, but what happens when they do the traditional female thing of having a baby?
As far as the impending arrival of our new baby and after the Stanley Cup Finals, the club has been very supportive. They want me to return to my job and have gone out of their way to make me feel that whatever problems may arise with having a new baby, they are able to cope with it, whether it means a change in my hours or more help that I need in the office. They're willing to have me back with a new baby.
Last year I covered the Islanders all the way through the Stanley Cup, and it was sort of touch and go at the end because I was expecting a baby any minute, and fortunately she didn't arrive until June 11th, and the Islanders won the cup on the last Saturday in May, so we both made it through.
Mary Flannery, Rosanda Scalbania, and Susie Matthew, three members of the fair sex who are holding down responsible positions in the busy world of hockey.
Well, women becoming prominent in many roles in hockey, I guess the question is, when will we see a woman playing in the NHL? But first, there is an in-between step. We haven't yet had a female coach. And we still don't on Hockey Night in Canada. We have Don Cherry in the coach's corner. Women allowed, but not right now, because Don is in there taking up all the room. And we'll get to that. Hockey Night in Canada continues in just a moment.
今天所看到的一切.
At electric power sites in Canada, engineers from China are learning new techniques. They know Canadians have one of the most reasonably priced and reliable electric power services in the world. And like many other countries, they come to study our innovations, like pioneering extra high voltage transmission.
Well done, Canada.
Constant innovation. It's one reason Canadians enjoy one of the most reasonably priced and reliable electric power services in the world.
Mustang, engineered to turn high mileage into high excitement. No wonder North America's most popular sporty car is Mustang. Hot stuff.
Thank you. Come again.
One family bucket, please.
Excuse me, would you call yourself a frequent buyer of Kentucky Fried Chicken?
My family could eat the Colonel's chicken every night of the week.
I guess that would cost a bit.
Well, I don't know. When you consider the price of food these days, Kentucky Fried Chicken's a really good buy. Oh, Mary, better give me a large coleslaw as well, please.
Say, you are a regular customer. Don't you ever buy any other chicken?
Oh, we've tried them all. But at our house, the only chicken's Kentucky Fried Chicken. There's nothing like it.
Have you ever wondered if one heating supplier is better than another? Then ask yourself, does he have a 24-hour emergency line? Or a furnace maintenance plan? Has he ever let you run out of oil? Is your home clean and tidy after a service call? If you're getting the wrong answers, call your SO Home Comfort associate and get the right ones. SO Home Comfort, the time for answers is now.
The Islanders by a crossbar and the tick of a clock, still ahead of Minnesota by a score of 3-2. Two periods completed in game number two of this Stanley Cup Final. Welcome to the Coach's Corner. And we want to talk to Don Cherry about what goes on at the bench, specifically behind it in a coach's role. But first, one more dressing room question that pertains to what we just saw. If you're Sonmore, are you telling them now, look, you should be tied? Or would it be counterproductive to remind them of the frustration they must be feeling on the Broughton play?
Well, I don't know what counterproductive means, but I know one thing. You never mention it, you forget it, and it never happened, because if you bring it up, they'll only get down. It never happened.
Okay, we're usually talking about dressing rooms and strategy prior to the game. I really want to talk about some of the things that go on at the bench, and we've heard a couple of mentions of Glenn Sonmore calling the players by their first and last names. Now, it's no big deal that he knows them, although I suppose there are some coaches who've been known to forget from time to time. But why is it important, if it's important, that he uses both names?
Well, it's quite obvious. He's got two guys named Smith, and he's been burned a couple of times, so now he's gotten the habit. I had the same habit. I used to call the last names, and I had Dallas Smith, Rick Smith, and I got burned a couple of times, so I was calling them by their first name all the time. Last year, 2 years ago, I had five guys named Mike. I'd say, oh, Mike, get ready. The whole team would stand up. So it's you have to watch that, because it'll cost you games.
Wouldn't nicknames help in that respect?
Well, yeah, you'll never believe, it's hard to believe, but Ricky Smith and Ricky Middleton came on the club, so I couldn't say, so I called them Nifty. That's their nickname. Both guys had the nickname Nifty. Figure that one out.
All right, I'd like to figure out whose fault it is when a team is called, and this is not personal, for having too many men on the ice. There are people say it's the player's fault, he should know better. Others say the coach must take the ultimate responsibility.
Well, the coach, a ship goes down, it's his fault, the captain's fault. It really isn't. He might have been sleeping. But what happens is, it's always the guy that jumps on, everybody's looking at him. It's not their fault at all. 9 out of 10 times, it's the guy that's coming over. He relaxes, he starts coasting, and Calgary does this a lot. He starts coasting, the other guy jumps on, you know, he's anxious to get on there and everything, and too many men, and it's always the guy coming off's fault.
Okay, some anecdotes about what goes on the bench. I'm sure there's some humorous moments as talk goes back and forth. Maybe a coach is trying to criticize a player, and a player has a line for him in return that might later be considered humorous. Some moments in your career that you can remember?
Well, I remember one time with Punch Imlach. I played for Punch, and I was playing with a guy named Bob Armstrong, and he said, Bob Armstrong up and thingamabob. That's me, thingamabob. I wouldn't go on at all. They had the face off. I'm waiting there and everything. Never went on the ice, and he never put me on. In fact, he never put me on for another month.
Okay. If you want to discipline a player during the game, you've seen a shift and you didn't like what you saw from that particular player, you want to leave him on the bench, is there a way to do it that gets the message home?
Well, what you do, say it's Winsink, O'Reilly, and McNabb. Fine line. I love that line. But anyhow, you want to bench Winsink. So what you say, McNabb's line up, Marcotte left wing. And the guy's head goes down, he kicks the boards, but he gets the point very, very fast.
And is that... Does that carry on for very long, or after a game, do you forget it?
Well, came on the club, so I couldn't say, so I called him Nifty. That's their nickname. Both guys had the nickname Nifty. Figure that one out.
All right, I'd like to figure out whose fault it is when a team is called, and this is not personal, for having too many men on the ice. There are people say it's the player's fault, he should know better. Others say the coach must take the ultimate responsibility.
Well, the coach, a ship goes down, it's his fault, the captain's fault. It really isn't, he might have been sleeping, but what happens is, it's always the guy that jumps on, everybody's looking at him. It's not their fault at all. 9 out of 10 times, it's the guy that's coming over. He relaxes, he starts coasting, and Calgary does this a lot. He starts coasting, the other guy jumps on, you know, he's anxious to get on there and everything, and too many men, and it's always the guy coming off's fault.
Okay, some anecdotes about what goes on the bench. I'm sure there's some humorous moments as talk goes back and forth. Maybe a coach is trying to criticize a player, and a player has a line for him in return that might later be considered humor. Some moments in your career that you can remember?
Well, I remember one time with Punch Imlach. I played for Punch, and I was playing with a guy named Bob Armstrong, and he said, Bob Armstrong up and thingamabob. That's me, thingamabob. I wouldn't go on at all. They had the face off. I'm waiting there and everything. Never went on the ice, and he never put me on. In fact, he never put me on for another month.
Okay. If you want to discipline a player during the game, you've seen a shift and you didn't like what you saw from that particular player, you want to leave him on the bench, is there a way to do it that gets the message home?
Well, what you do, say it's Winsink, O'Reilly, and McNabb. Fine line. I love that line. But anyhow, you want to bench Winsink. So what you say, McNabb's line up, Marcotte left wing. And the guy's head goes down, he kicks the boards, but he gets the point very, very fast.
And does that carry on for very long, or after a game, do you forget it?
Well, no, you got to forget that because the guy's mad. But I think the funniest thing is when a guy's benched for two periods, and you tell him, okay, I want Smith out there. They'll let on they don't hear you. They'll actually stare ahead and let on they don't hear you. You got to go down and tap and put him on. And the guy that used to get me was Kenny Hodge. You know, he'd be benched for a while. He'd get on the ice, and he'd start flexing his legs, you know, telling me that I haven't put him on, letting the 17,000 people go. It might not be a good shift because I haven't played on. He's trying to embarrass the coach, telling everybody that he's been sitting there and his legs are like lead.
Okay, Don Terry, thank you very much. We have played two periods at the Nassau Coliseum for the Islanders ahead by a score of 3-2. We'll return to the Stanley Cup Finals in just a moment.
It's a good feeling when you get your loan from a bank you can count on.
You know, buying a camper has made this the best holiday we've ever had. But we'd never have done it without that Commerce loan.
Hey guys, come get it.
Count on the Commerce.
This new ski lodge will be open next winter, thanks to the people at the Commerce. They set up a great business loan plan for me.
Count on the Commerce.
Took a big loan to buy this tractor, but my commerce manager was right there. But the deal had made sense.
Count on the Commerce.
I could have bought a new car, but I always dreamed of owning one of these. A loan from our bank helped me get it.
Count on the Commerce for the loan you need at more branches than any other bank in Canada.
You can count on the Commerce.
Introducing a North American car designed for a changing world and with a commitment to quality. Introducing the beautifully new Ford Granada. Built with a new design, smaller exterior, yet more spacious than ever before. Built with Granada's highest mileage ratings ever, 35 miles per gallon. And built with Ford's quality control system, every car is examined during assembly by at least 38 inspectors. The new Granada, new for a changing world, from Ford.
Water power. For nearly 100 years, Canadian General Electric has been helping turn this natural resource into electricity, bringing progress to Canadians. Today, CGE is Canada's leader in high-voltage technology, which transmits that power more efficiently than ever before to industries like this giant steel mill, where it's put to work helping provide products and jobs for Canadians. Progress for people from Canadian General Electric.
that second period of hockey, excellent. Both teams having several good scoring opportunities, but the North Stars, when they were down by two, that goal by Palmer gave them a lot of life, and they came on a lot stronger near the end of the period.
No question about it, Gary. I think that's the best period of hockey we've seen in the final. It's certainly Minnesota's best period, and we're going to have a look at a couple of replays here. First of all, here comes the breakaway by Broughton right at the end of the period, and it tells you how things are going for Minnesota. The guy's got to get a breakaway with no time left on the clock as he shoots, and we're still not sure if it went in or not. It came down right on the line, so it seemed, but with no time on the clock, just a bad break for Minnesota.
Well, right away, though, the green light did come on, and that automatically signified no goal. And so, getting ready to start the third period, let's go over to Bob Cole.
Thank you, Gary, and thank you, Mickey. We're ready now for what could be the final 20 minutes of this game. Of course, as you know, playoff hockey overtime is always a factor. Right now, it's 3-2, only one goal separating these two teams, and Minnesota, as Gary and Mickey just pointed out, have come on strong in this hockey game, especially in that second period just over. Now we're in the third. Minnesota trying to cover up in their own zone. That's Gordy Roberts dumping it out. At center, Potvin for Tonelli. Tonelli's pass grabbed at the blue line, and there's Tim Young coming in. Gets set, took a shot. Smith lost it. He scored. Smith made the save and lost it. And then the puck was driven home, and I believe Smith has been injured. After that play, he twisted something. He looks to be in bad pain.
I wonder if that was on the original shot there, Bob.
Looks like his right shoulder, it's the right arm area, either the elbow. He may have come down on the elbow when he tried to get the rebound. You'll see the replay here, Young taking the original shot from out by the blue line, and Payne come flying in. Smith got it with a right pad, I think. Here you'll see the puck go off to the right. You see him go down. He looks all right there, and he tries to get over for this rebound right there.
I think the skate, or perhaps when Steve Payne slid into Billy Smith, may have knocked his arm into the goalpost.
That's right, Gary. Right after the goal had been scored, Payne had gone by, and I think you're right. I think you're right. A skate did hit him.
But what a big goal by the Minnesota North Stars. And Mickey, we've talked so often the importance of that second man heading for the net, always the possibility for a rebound.
Young and Roberts got assists on the goal. And you say, Gary, what a time for a goal, and what a big goal it is. Only 30 seconds into this third period. We have a brand new game. It's tied now at 3.
You see the backup goaltender, Melanson, wondering if he has to go into the nets. They're still looking at Billy Smith right now, getting up very slowly.
Boy, he looked to be in pain. He was spinning around on the ice. They've still left the puck there just to show you nobody thought about anything else but Billy Smith.
I'm sure a lot of questions on that Minnesota North Stars bench. You know, will Billy Smith be able to continue? The enthusiasm by the North Stars have to be at a high right now, getting a goal so early. In fact, 30 seconds, that's all it took to tie this game.
Isn't it amazing? The last second of the second period, Minnesota came within an eyelash of tying the game, and then going to the dressing room, knowing that they had a break, Broughton on that breakaway, but they obviously didn't get down. They came right out here in the third period, and after only 30 seconds, boom.
You know, it's funny, you guys talked before the game and during the game about a certain individual into the lineup tonight that might make a difference, and guess who? Timmy Young.
Yes.
Started the playoff, and he's figured in a big goal here for the North Stars.
Well, we kind of questioned that, Mickey, because we were saying one good hit, and perhaps Tim Young could be lost for the balance of the year. And we kind of questioned Glenn Sonmore putting him in, but he must have had the doctor's approval. But Timmy Young, on that play there, let the shot go. It handcuffed Billy Smith and Steve Payne. What an excellent move to rush in and put that rebound home.
You remember the comment Don Cherry made when we started this series just two nights ago. Listen, this is playoffs. If you can get a guy in there at all, there's no tomorrow. You got to do it. And, you know, Gary, they were down a game. They want to win one here. I think slippers. Okay, he's going to stay in. They want to win one here, if at all possible, before they go back home to Minnesota. And I suppose Sean Moore thought along the same lines as Don Cherry and said, okay, Timmy, we're going to go. After the warm-up, he must have told him he felt okay. And then he told me before the game tonight, Glenn Sean Moore did, that right now Bobby says it looks questionable, but we'll know for sure after the warm-up. And there's what happened, and Tim Young figured in on this goal.
Well, confidence is a big thing, and it seemed that since Brad Palmer has scored in that second period, the North Stars are playing with a lot more confidence.
So at just 30 seconds, Steve Payne from Young and Roberts, and it's tied at 3.
So look at Big Gillies, Islander left winger, who on a power play loves to get in front of that goaltender. Gary, you mentioned earlier that he's been throwing his weight around quite a bit. He hasn't been doing that the last couple of years that much, but he really was doing it here tonight and in game one against Minnesota on Tuesday night.
What that does, Mickey, it gives him a lot more room out there because players are a little hesitant going close to him because they know they're going to get beat up.
No question about it.
Now this is Hartsburg to Bobby Smith. He has been rather silent for a superstar of this team in this final series so far. Of course, we've only played 1 2/3 of a game. Goring coming to center. Goring up over the line, stops, gets it back, and 3 Minnesota North Stars just about broke out of the zone, but Smith overskated it. Now he tries to get away from Kallur, can't do it. Kallur keeping it in with Goring's help. Kallur's weak shot, stop. McCarthy spoiled his shot. Smith cruising back there. Goring looking for it, he has it. Centered it, what a great save. Another one by Beaupre. 2 beautiful saves. I'll tell you, you gotta watch that Goring. He's always on the puck. And you talk about forechecking, he'll not only take it on you, but he'll set somebody up in the quick of an eye. Bang! Right on the stick of Kallur, and he came close.
Well, that's a save of the hockey game, I'm gonna tell you. Kallur let it go instantly. As soon as it hit his stick, he let it fly. And Beaupre, I don't know how he got across there, because he was covering the short side over there with Goring. Look at this, bingo, right off the left pad.
Well, the scouting report on Don Beaupre, he has the quickness, quick like a cat, they say, and he certainly demonstrated on that play, robbing Kallur of a sure goal.
Wait a minute and a half in the third period. Score tied, 3-3. There's Billy Smith, shaken up. After that goal was scored at 30 seconds, he looks to be okay now. The Islanders come away. Bossy, Trottier. Trottier breaking in. Get set now. Try to poke it in front. And the North Stars are back to cover up. They're watching Bourne over there in front of the net. Long shot went wide of the goal. McEwen from the other side driving it. That was tipped away. Here's Bourne now. He's trying to set it up. Trottier to Bossy. Big backhander. Tipped away by Beaupre. Great pressure by the Islanders. Finally, that comes across the line. Langevin will come in for the drive. At the line, lets it go. It's off Barrett. Greg Smith back of the net for Minnesota. They're trying to move it out. Kristoff gets it out. Comes to center. Kristoff hitting the New York line. Run into the boards and not flying. And a faceoff called for just outside the New York line. Long Island, this is Stanley Cup 81.
This year, I'm the entertainment committee, and this is the entertainment. So I got batteries that'll last. Duracell.
Tests prove after just a few hours, regular carbon batteries wear out. But you can get up to 4 times more use from Duracell. Duracell batteries last longer.
Look, if the music stopped, so would the fun.
Duracell. The copper top battery. No regular battery looks like it.
Or lasts like it.
Bob Cole with Gary Dornhofer and Mickey Redmond nearing the 3-minute mark of the third period. It's tied at 3. Merrick at center ice for New York. Tim Young for Minnesota. That's Young forechecking, causing some trouble. In goes McAdam. Smith out of the net. Hooked it high over the glass. Here we are in the third period. Crucial game here in the Stanley Cup Final. I'm sitting next to 2 former veterans, stars, Gary Dornhofer with the Philadelphia Flyers and Mickey Redmond with the Montreal Canadiens, Detroit Red Wings. You 2 guys have been in this situation before. What's going on in the heads down there?
Well, for the North Stars, I think it's important in their own zone that they don't run around. You saw in that last sequence there, they were running around and they left the points open. If you give the Islanders shots from that point, you're going to be in trouble. I think they have to keep their composure, and sometimes that's very hard to do.
Ricky? Well, it's going to be just like overtime hockey here. A few more minutes go by. Every shift is very important. Of course, every shot on the net. And they play it just like they do in overtime.
Here's a chance for Minnesota. At the line, Giles couldn't keep it in. Giles from center nearly lost it to the dangerous Merrick. McAdam shooting one in wide. There's Tonelli speeding back. Why, he works miles a game, Tonelli does. Shoots it outside the line. Giles will shoot it back in. Tipped by Morrow into the corner. That's Morrow stopping. Feeds it up to Nystrom. Nystrom turning. Gets a pass to the line. It's broken up right there by Ciccarelli, but he couldn't shoot it. Maxwell for Minnesota. And the Stars are looking better, I'll tell you. They shoot it in. It's in wide of the net. Denis Potvin turning. Lead pass for Gillies. Picked off by Ciccarelli. A penalty coming up. Ciccarelli was not just inside the line. Spun high and wide. And there's a New York penalty. Tonight's Stanley Cup playoff game is coming to you from Long Island.
Oh, my favorite designer label shirts. But I'd like some with the patented mark collar.
Only Arrow has the patented mark collar.
Only Arrow? Hey, wait a minute. These styles are really great.
Only Arrow has the revolutionary patented mark collar. Shaped not like a tube, but like a cone to fit the contours of your neck for comfort like never before. And a fresh, crisp look with the neckband out of sight. Excuse me, didn't you want some of those too?
No, no. Only Arrow.
Have a penalty, and it's the big man right there, Denis Potvin.
Well, Potvin taking the feet from under Ciccarelli. You see right there, he makes a bad pass. Tries to make up for it by pitchforking Ciccarelli, and Lewis right there to make the call. A critical situation for the Islanders here. Game tied at 3.
Mickey, this will be the Islanders' 6th power play opportunity of the evening. Remember, they had a 2-man advantage at one point. They have scored 1 power play goal. The Islanders have only had 2 power play opportunities.
Well, this is a crucial time, critical time, as you said, Mickey Redmond, for the New York Islanders. The score is tied at 3. This penalty coming at 3:39 of this third period. Minnesota have been strong lately, and now a man advantage.
Bob, may I be corrected? The Islanders have had only 1 power play opportunity. They have scored on it.
Okay, Gary. There's Carroll chipping it on the boards. Still inside the line. Play comes over, but Lane knocked it down. Shoots at the center. That's Giles backing up. Giles feeds a pass ahead. At center, it's knocked down. Carroll trying to cause trouble. Bobby Smith, nice play for Ciccarelli. But Goring all over him. Puck slides to Goring to Ciccarelli. Lane goes in. Lane has it, holding it with his skate. Trying to hang on to it. Maybe kill some time. He does, but the whistle goes now. Get a face-off in the New York Islanders zone with a minute and 25 seconds left in the Potvin penalty.
You know, you can almost see the upsurge in excitement in the North Stars players. They can feel it. They're in this building. As Gary mentioned earlier, they came in to win one game if possible. Well, right now they've got it within their grasp. They're on a power play, only 15 minutes left in the hockey game, and you can just see the adrenaline's going, and they're really playing with a lot more confidence out there right now.
And didn't it look like the Islanders were the team that were standing around now and watching, and the North Stars taking over with their speed that they have?
That's Tim Young again. He falls, gets a weak pass away, though. It was good enough for McAdam. Young again feeds it in front. Goring got a stick in the way of it. And it's cleared on the boards. Maxwell knocked it down and kept it in for Minnesota. Again, they kill some seconds. Here comes Tim Young centering it. Close call in front of the net with Steve Payne nearly jamming it home. That's Payne leaving it for McAdam. Back of the goal. McAdam centering it. Billy Smith covers up. You're going to hear the crowd hollering now. And look at Lane going after the referee. Bryan Lewis hollering for a penalty. The fans thought. And I'll tell you, Lane better watch it, fellas, because Lewis will have him gone for 10. He'd hate to do it with this situation. But if he keeps it up, I know he's warned him by this time. Look at this.
Things are so bad, we have the fans hollering and screaming at us, and we're not even making the calls down there. We had one guy just yelling at us.
Who's screaming at you, Gary?
One of the fans.
Show me. Mickey, you take care of it.
get them.
Goodness sake.
Times are tough up here.
Got to remember, we're in Long Island. Going to wear my hard hat the next time I'm over here.
That's Langevin back of the net. Goes flying over the glass into the crowd. Now, Mickey, you stay right there.
Well, Gary, we've got to protect our play-by-play guy at all costs. The game must go on.
I'm okay. You two guys are 6'2", 6'1", 200. And I'm five what?
125 pounds.
Come on.
Booming steel.
That's one arm. Face off to the right of Billy Smith. Here comes Maxwell. Hartsburg flipped it in front. Payne got it back. Another shot. Islanders will clear it now. Off the boards, down the ice. Time remaining in Potvin's penalty. 35 seconds. 3-3 tie. Minnesota, man advantage. They know they must do something with this opportunity. Down the right side, McAdam trying to go in. Nice play comes to the line. Payne slips the pass over. And it's Kallur who will clear it. Out with Trottier. He might bring it in. He will bring it in. Kallur nearly going all the way. Falls. Listen to the fans now, but he fell. No penalty there. Coming up to the six-minute mark. Potvin, 5 seconds left in that penalty. Gets ready to step back on. Minnesota can't get anything going on this power play. It's cleared down the ice by New York. Penalty is over. Beaupre didn't know it. He's out of the net to touch it. That might have been icing had he stayed in there. Up to center. Anderson is belted and sent flying by Gordy Lane. I tell you, we got a hockey game for you now, folks. Don't leave us. At the six-minute mark of the third period, it's tied at 3 here in New York. Minnesota fighting back, trying to even the series. Islanders with a convincing win. On Tuesday night, there's Lane. Tipping it to Gillies. Big Pat Gillies gets it up across the line. It's knocked down by Barrett. Gillies comes on, though. That's Gillies barreling in. Knocked down. Penalty coming up against Greg Smith of Minnesota. This is Hockey Night in Canada from Long Island.
It takes calm, unhurried patience to brew Bredor, so take the time to appreciate it. Bredor from Molson. Take the time.
Not Smith, as you see, it's Brock for hooking. 6:22 the time.
Well, wow. The big guy, Clark Gillies, was in full stride, and Neil Broughton hauls him down, so the Islanders will get their second power play opportunity. They scored on their first one.
Now it's a big test for Minnesota. The score is tied at 3. The New York Islanders, need I say more, they're on a power play opportunity, and they're devastating, given the man advantage. There's Bossy with Trottier. Trottier, Bourne, Bossy up front, into Bossy, back of the net. He tried to center it, but it's deflected back of the goal. Trottier and Barrett pushing and shoving in front of the net. Dennis Potvin knocked down. Along the boards, it comes loose. Potvin working it in the circle. Back to Bourne. Bourne to Bossy. Here it comes. Whistle goes. We got double penalties coming up. The scrapping going on to the right of Don Beaupre, you would not believe. Trottier, they're trying to push him out of the crease. He and Barrett, I think, will be Barrett will go off. And now some more pushing and shoving. That's the goaltender that Trottier wants a piece of. Trottier goes off. With a score, Islanders 3, North Stars 3. This is Stanley Cup 81.
McDonald's presents a whole new way to love chicken.
McChicken!
Oh, a hot chicken sandwich. Great idea.
Nobody makes chicken like McDonald's. Plump, tender chicken cooked a special way, so it's crunchy golden brown on the outside and juicy on the inside.
It's very good.
It's very new.
With lettuce, a tasty sauce, and served hot on a toasted sesame seed bun.
Nobody can do it.
McDonald's, you've done it again.
Like McDonald's.
Devils can.
Gary, this is your area right here in front of the net where this penalty comes from. Trottier and Barrett, watch it.
Well, both guys, Barrett and Trottier, you see him to the left of your screen, Trottier, and he's getting a pretty good shot there by Beaupre, and they go at it. They both get high-sticking penalties. And Beaupre, after a shaky start in that first period, has really settled down, playing some solid goaltending.
And looks very confident while he's doing it. Bossy now slides it back. Here's a shot by McEwen, and Beaupre standing right there on the edge of the crease, cuts the angle, makes the save, and hangs on to it.
North Stars were very fortunate there. Everybody was over on the right-hand side. Anderson should have been playing his position on the left. Well, got attracted by that puck. McEwen had a good shot.
They try to set up that box situation, and when it breaks down, you can really allow some good scoring chances on your goaltender.
3-3 tie. We're in the third period. Minnesota shorthanded, shooting it down the ice. A minute and 3 seconds left in Broughton's penalty. Coming out, McEwen and Gillies. Up the center is Gillies shooting it in. Beaupre back to the net. Get back in there, young fella. He wanted to roam a bit, but saw the Islanders sweep in. And here's Potvin getting set. Pass ahead to Goring to Potvin. Took the shot. It was blocked. Goring now might try it. No, he goes over to McEwen. Now Potvin, he'll shoot it this time, I think. Nope, into Goring. Goring to Potvin again. This time the shot, beautiful save by Beaupre. And he moved that right leg. Here's Potvin again. Goring closing in. Blocked in front. Goring to Potvin. Scores! Potvin picks the high left-hand corner. And Beaupre, no chance. He was too close, it was too hard, and it's Islanders 4, North Stars 3.
Boy, this is the prettiest example of the give and go between Goring and Potvin. There's the first chance that was blocked, and watch Goring set it back again to Potvin. This is the third time he's done it, the wrist shot. Top corner again over Beaupre's glove. But just before that, Gary, they moved that puck back and forth. Goring to Potvin, back to Goring, back to Potvin. A slow little pass, and boom, he let it go right away, and finally it paid off.
But Anderson really got taken into his own zone. He was almost standing beside one of the defensemen, and that allowed Potvin that extra time to unload it. He got a chance to move in from the top of the slot. But look at the battle in front, and you'll see Anderson come into the picture.
This is the first shot by
Goring. Now watch Anderson, look at him. He's no good there. What's he doing out there?
Exactly. He's caught way back in his zone. He's almost, I think he screens Beaupre on it as well. But the Islanders just tremendous puck control. And I guess it forces a guy to make mistakes like that.
Two power play goals tonight. Two times at bat for the Islanders.
8 minutes, the time of the goal. McCarthy fan on a shot for Minnesota. Keller missed the pass at his own line. Minnesota, who tied it up in 30 seconds of this period, and now down a goal again. Here's Kallur coming in. Kallur jams the brakes on, fanned on it. Gillies took the shot, a hard shot, but wide. It was all the way back to center. That's Lane. Lane, feed on the far wing. Kallur couldn't pick it up on the boards. And back to Hartsburg. Up over the line, he stopped. Lost control of it. Lorimer shoots one down the ice. This will be icing. As Maxwell comes back for Minnesota. Hockey Night in Canada will continue in a moment.
We want to make you smile.
Mr. Simmons called and said to see you at 4:30 about the contract.
Good thing it's right across the street.
We're going to make you smile.
Holiday Inn hotels are near where you need to be.
Right on time.
And that can be important.
You got it.
Is my smile that big?
Come to Holiday Inn where your smile says we're number one of people pleasing.
Bob Cole, Derry Dornhofer, and Mickey Redmond. 11:09 left of the period. 4-3 Islanders. Steve Payne scored at 30 seconds from Robertson Young. And Potvin, power play goal from Goring at 8 minutes. Giving the Islanders that one goal lead again. That's the picture right now as they line up for the draw to the right of Billy Smith. Comes right back to the defenseman to center ice. Giles being watched by Merrick. Gets it up to Roberts. His pass went by Lane. Lane comes back. of Beaupre. That's Roberts back, and icing again called against the New York Islanders.
Well, Gordy Lane just got away with something down there. Put the hook on the Minnesota player, and I think everybody in the building a little bit of an ooh. Thought they were going to call a penalty, but Lewis didn't make the call. But you get the last 10 minutes of a hockey game of this importance. It really has to be a pretty bad penalty for Lewis to call it, really. He's not going to call any cheap stuff tonight at this point in time. It's got to be a real gross error on somebody's part before you send him off.
Well, that goal scorer, number five, the captain, Denis Potvin, and he says, we don't seem to worry about anything, whether we're down a goal or up a couple. We just go about and do our job. Islanders again with the lead.
There's Giles' shot, but just missed the far corner. Not by much. Merrick stopped the pass. Ahead to Nystrom, and hit him on the leg. Coming in on the other side is the hard-working Tonelli, digging for the corner. Set over here to Giles. Tonelli is after him. Out to Young, and he tipped it ahead. McAdam can't catch up to it. Potvin was there first. Back for New York. Nystrom on the right side, and this is Merrick bringing it in, dropping it to Nystrom. Nystrom knocked down. Here's Tonelli. Around the net, he's centered it. It comes back to Tim Young. He's away with Payne on the left. Now on the right as they swing around. Back to Payne. Takes the shot. Cuts for the net. The backhander is grabbed by Billy Smith. And the goaltender hangs on to it. 10:06 remaining in the third period. Islanders 4, North Stars 3.
Well, Denis Potvin is also one of the Islanders that has played in every game, every Stanley Cup playoff game since they've been in it. 94, tonight being the 95th game. Hasn't missed one.
Islanders with a draw, their own zone. Langevin up for Bourne. He was stopped on the boards by Kristoff. Minnesota fighting for it now. That's Beaupre going after Bourne. But the pass to McEwen sets it back to Bourne. Hitting center. Bourne trying to shoot it in. Langevin trailing the play. But Bourne was offside at the Minnesota line. 9:45. Time ever important now for Minnesota. Tell you, gentlemen, if the Stars could pull this one out here before going back to Minnesota, you know what the crowd does to this team back there in Bloomington?
They certainly played well enough to win a hockey game here. Certainly a long way from over here with 9:40 left in the third period.
Langevin coming out. Pass to McEwen, hopping over center, looking dangerous. This is McEwen, and he flipped it up high. Comes back in front of the net. All the North Stars are back covering up. Frank Smith was belted by Trottier. Is he tough on his skates? Bossy is not flying. And the crowd on their feet here in the Coliseum. What another penalty. First, that's normal. Rotten up to Kristoff. His shot blocked. There's Bourne with it. Decides to shoot it into the Minnesota zone. 9 minutes left in the third period. Coming out, Maxwell. Here he is. Maxwell up to center. Rips one. Look out. Billy Smith caught him in the midsection. He did not go down. Held onto it. Knocked it away. Not Goring. He's coming in with Gillies. He'll give it to Gillies. Gillies stops. Tried to make an extra move and couldn't. Back of the net is Goring. Goring tipped it over to Kallur. Down goes Bryan, or rather Beaupre, and hangs on to it. And I'll tell you, he had to scamper across that goal line in order to get over on that post. Young Beaupre looking good.
You see Goring again involved in that give and go. He loves to make that play. And you're talking about Gillies getting that big body in motion, Gary, earlier. He's really flying out there today. It's the best I've seen him skate in a long time.
Well,
he's playing well, but, you know, he's flying.
I talked to him this morning. He wants to get this over as fast as he can. He says the weather is good. There's a lot of golf courses open, and he wants to get out there and hit that long ball. And can he hit it?
I'll try to. Lane flipped it into the corner. That's Smith. Tony intercepted that. Wasn't a good play inside the New York line. Kallur knocked it across the line to Goring. In front of the net it comes. Here's Gillies. And Beaupre is out again. To knock it away from Todd Gillies. I thought the big fellow had one. Live from Long Island, the Stanley Cup playoffs.
Feel and sell the brother. How'd you do that trick?
It's all in the stick. I taught him everything he knows.
Bob Cole with Gary Dornhofer, Mickey Redmond, Coliseum, Long Island is our spot now. Game two of the Stanley Cup Final. Islanders lead the series 1-0. This game 4-3. Hot fan. Left hit. And that's the score! Cam Morrow took what looked to be a harmless shot, and it was deflected in front of the net. And it's 5-3, New York.
That looks like Wayne Merrick, and you know, again, very instrumental in getting the faceoffs. In game one, he won 11 of 19. That's twice tonight now. He's got the faceoff that has resulted in goals. And Mickey, I think he deflects this one in front.
It looks like Merrick does. You see Beaupre going down to make the shot. When he focuses on the shot coming from Morrow, it's hard for him to move again if it's redirected. And I think it had to be touched by Merrick.
Number six.
No, it was. Morrow. They're giving it to Morrow at this point.
I believe that they will change that. But you got to give Morrow a lot of credit for putting that thing right along the ice.
Got it through, and that's the big thing for a defenseman. Those forwards work very hard in the corners. And you know, Gary, most frustrating thing for a forward is you work hard to get it back to the point and then dump it back at the corner again. They can get it through to the net, boy. What a big difference it makes.
11:57, the time of the goal. Merrick and Potvin assisting on the goal by Morrow. That's the official announcement. Icing now called against Minnesota. 7:52 remaining. 5-3 Islanders.
Well, Wayne Merrick has become a very valuable member of this hockey club. We look at Morrow. At the beginning of the year, he was not playing regular, seeing spot duty, and all of a sudden, killing penalties on a regular shift. This unit here of Merrick, Tonelli, and Nystrom have been very aggressive in games one and also in this one.
Minnesota now in a bit of a hole, down two goals. And you know the New York Islanders will not sit back with a two-goal lead. Here's Tonelli now getting it back. At the blue line is Potvin. Potvin feeds it in. Merrick looking for Moll. Goes the other way in the corner. Nystrom swoops in. Nystrom shooting. That's knocked down. Blocked in front by Giles. Nystrom again. Cleared it back of the net for Tonelli. And went by him. Anderson left it for Payne. He can't move it out. Islanders stay with it. And they get a faceoff inside the Minnesota line with 7:19 remaining. 5-3 New York.
Well, you talk about persistence and forechecking. These guys out there, Gary, you were talking about them. Merrick and Tonelli and Nystrom, they'll drive you crazy. They just never leave you alone. The legs are gone. They're jumping on top of you. You look at Potvin, his 100th career point at the assist on, as it stands now, Kenny Morrow's goal. We'll wait to see if we get a change on that, as it looked like Merrick may have redirected that puck in front of Beaupre. But this line has just been incredible. They've been kept constant pressure on the North Stars.
And Mickey, that line is used for checking. They're supposed to be the checking unit out there, and they have contributed in the goal department as much as any other line. I feel that in the first two games here in the Island, they have been the best line in both games.
Last scoring play again. Morrow for Merrick and Potvin. 11:57. They're in again. Bourne slapping at it. Right in front, jamming at it. Beaupre reached back. Nearly had himself a goal. He's having fits tonight. He had so many chances up at the other end a period ago, and now he saw it there, nearly knocked it over the line, but could not.
Well, you have a look at what happened here. Bossy gets the big chance in front right there, and he gets it in behind Beaupre with a little backhand right there. Look at Bourne. He's got the open net again, and he can't get the handle on it. Beaupre finally fouls on it, the whistle blowing, but Bourne's got to be very frustrated right about now.
He'll be thinking about that tonight. Maybe he'll watch the movies like Coach Al Arbour does. After a game, he'll go home and put that video machine on and watch the whole game again. There isn't a guy that prepares more for a hockey game than Al Arbour. We will never lose a game because of lack of preparation. That's his motto.
7 minutes and 11 seconds. The end of regulation time in this game two of the Stanley Cup Final from the Coliseum in Long Island, New York. I'm Bob Cole with Gary Dornhofer and Mickey Redmond, two former NHL stars. Langevin played it over there. Here's McEwen, scramble for it with Beaupre out of the net. Another penalty now coming up, and the fans do not like this. Again, we get Bossy and Trottier talking to Beaupre. This Stanley Cup playoff game is coming to you from Long Island.
The new Mercury Lynx, built in North America with world-class fuel economy. 54 miles per gallon highway, 42 miles per gallon combined city highway. Lynx, with outstanding performance from a unique CVH engine, advanced transmission, and aerodynamic shape. Lynx, front-wheel drive for traction, four-wheel independent suspension for smoothness, advanced computer technology, and a spacious inner world for four adults. A world-class car built in North America. Mercury Lynx.
There's Bryan Trottier, a tripping penalty here at 12:58 of this third period. And again, Gary and Mickey, Minnesota have an opportunity to get close, and then you never know.
Well, we have to score one on this power play, but Beaupre, he is clearing the front of the net, swinging that stick around pretty good. And that's what Bossy was talking to him about.
He's got the attention getter back there, that big goal stick.
Solves a lot of problems, doesn't it?
For sure.
Hartsburg played it in. Coming in is Tim Young. He's knocked fine, sliding into the boards. And he is playing hurt. Gets back up slowly. He's all right. Tim Young gets it in front. Shot blocked by Billy Smith. Young still fighting for it. Hartsburg at the line to Young. Young takes a look back here. Gives it to Hartsburg. A shot deflected in front. Scramble for it. And it's grabbed. I think we might get a penalty here. Wait a minute. One of the Islanders fell on a Denis Potvin. And brother, if he put his hand out, he's gone.
Well, he'll need an escort, Grant Lewis, while they get out of this building.
I'm going to tell you.
Potvin went down. It didn't look like he put his hand on Potvin. He put his body over.
But he's going to call him.
2 minutes for posing his hand on the puck.
You saw Al Arbour standing up, and he's normally very calm, cool, collected behind that bench. But that isn't the case right now. He was up on the top of the bench, had a few words for referee Ryan Lewis.
Well, Gary, if he doesn't put his hands on the puck, it's got to be a questionable call. There's a pileup in front of the net. Smith had made the save. The shot came through all the traffic, and Potvin just continued to fall down on top of the puck, so it seemed on the first look at it. But we'll have a look at it again. The North Stars putting that pressure on. You'll see the shot will come through from the point right about here. Potvin covering Payne in front of there. There's the shot right there. He pulls it in, but he pulled it into his body,
Yeah, well, he got the glove on it.
He got the glove on it.
A good call by Bryan Lewis. Of course, the fans here who continue to throw and holler and scream at us.
See, it is legal to put that hand on the puck and pull it into your body as long as you don't cover it with your hand.
You can't cover it, and that's obviously what he did, and he's gone for two. There's a shot from the line by Maxwell. Hartsburg broke his stick with that attempt. It's in the mesh, back of the goal, so they bring it outside the line for this faceoff.
Mickey, I really question the North Stars in the power play. They have a two-man advantage, and they're taking the shots from the point. I can't see or understand why they try to do this. Why not move a two-on-one against that top man of the triangle and work around him and get for a close-in shot?
No question about it. The only time I think they should be shooting from back there is if they've got somebody spotted beside the goaltender, and it's an open area to put a direct half a shot or like a pass shot to him so he can redirect it behind a goalie. But they should be moving the puck around more.
Trottier has 1:15 left in his penalty. Potvin 1:48. Minnesota trailing by two. Need a goal here badly. Maxwell couldn't keep it in. Chopped away and down the ice by Langevin. 1 minute left in Trottier's penalty. Minute and a half in Potvin's. Now the Minnesota North Stars. Coming in is Payne. On the wing is Young. Dropping it back for Hartsburg. Hartsburg. Backhand shot blocked in front of the net by Langevin. Scramble for it. They get a whistle. I'll tell you, the Islanders are doing a great job. Morrow, Langevin, and Goring. And 47 seconds left in Trottier's penalty. A minute and 20 in the penalty to Potvin.
That's been the difference of this hockey game. Eight times the North Stars have enjoyed a power play opportunity. On two occasions, two-man advantage. They have only scored one goal, and that was on the very first attempt. And if they go down to defeat, they can look at the power play that just really hasn't materialized.
No question about it. Of course, the Islanders doing a tremendous job of forechecking. Well, the shorthanded Goring, Billy Carroll, what a job they've done. Tonelli, Kallur's been out there a little bit. Boy, just a great job with a shorthanded.
Yeah, but Mickey, when you have a two-man advantage, you have to score in a case like that. Islanders would.
There's no question you should. Bobby Smith now with Ciccarelli on the right side. Giles is back on the defense with Roberts. As they line up to the right of Billy Smith, Smith himself will shoot it down this time. Crowd, love that. And 39 seconds left in Trottier's penalty. He's the first one who'll come on. Down for the North Stars. Giles stopped near center. But here comes Smith with Ciccarelli waiting for the drop pass. It doesn't cut. Smith back to the line to Giles. To Smith again. Bobby Smith had his pass intercepted. Now in the corner, goes back of the net. Lane to the corner again. Giles at the line. Put the shot blocked. Islanders clear down the ice. 9 seconds left in Trottier's penalty. That was Carroll who made that diving play. Giles again shooting one in. Now Trottier is on. They're one man short. 30 seconds left in Potvin's penalty. Giles gets it over. Roberts can't shoot it. It comes to the boards. Roberts again. Roberts back to the line to Giles. Shooting! Rebound! And Trottier one-on-one. Goring catching up. That's Trottier coming in. He's spun around, belted by Giles. Potvin will be on in 5 seconds. You'll hear one tremendous roar from this crowd as he steps on the ice. Here he is. Listen to the crowd. Islanders. Are they playing defensive hockey now? Can they ever do it? Doesn't make any difference how many they have on. Minnesota shooting it in. Back of the net. They'll get a whistle. If they do, you'll hear a standing ovation will happen right here. But they move it out. Instead, they pour it on. Lorimer playing it in. That's Beaupre tipping it back to the zone net. Only 4 minutes left in the third period. And it's 5-3 Islanders. Greg Smith up the line. The shot stopped by Billy Smith. He falls on it. Now you get the crowd standing. All on their feet. Two men short. A masterful defensive hockey. Penalty killing while shorthanded by two. And they held Minnesota up.
Well, 22-year-old Billy Carroll, he was out there. The scouting report, a great defensive forward. He showed it. He can kill penalties. And Al Arbour got a lot of confidence in that youngster. And there is a dejected Glenn Sonmore. The power play just didn't work tonight. Just hasn't got anything going. And that's very unfortunate for the North Stars, because when you get eight chances and only get one goal.
Well, usually, Gary, a power play will work at about a 25 to 30% clip, which is good for a couple of goals out of eight opportunities.
3:45 remaining, and it's 2-on-1. Trottier with Bossy. What more can you ask? What more can you ask? That's a record, by the way, for Trottier. A point for Trottier. Two Bossy. Beaupre lifting it off with some of the Islanders now. What a goal. 6-3. That'll do it in this one for the New York Islanders.
You think that is rubbing a little salt there after he scored against Beaupre?
Well, there's no question, Gary, about it. I'll tell you, the pass came over from Trottier. Bossy does come back over and say a few words as they mill around, but Bossy almost teed that puck up, knew exactly where he was going to put it, and he drilled it right in the top corner behind Beaupre. See, this all started earlier when Beaupre stuck the end of that big goal stick right around the throat area on Trottier, and a lot of the Islanders have been after him.
But what a perfect pass by Bryan Trottier.
Beautiful.
Between the skate and the stick. Hit Bossy in stride, and he made no mistake.
No question. He made no mistake for sure. He just buried that thing right up high.
That's his second of the game.
Mickey and Gary, to that point, by Trottier on the assist,
breaks a record held by Bobby Orr. A point scored in 14 consecutive playoff games. Watch it.
Watch Bossy tee this thing up. Look at that. He puts it out in front. He picks his spot high over that glove side, and he hit the target.
Well, talk about a well-executed two-on-one break. Trottier, who Coach Al Arbour said is the best center iceman in the National Hockey League, best player in the National Hockey League, sets up Bossy. Sunday night, the series will resume in Bloomington, Minnesota. The Islanders will be there, along with Bossy, Trottier, and the rest of the group. That'll be an 8:30 start Eastern time.
Like they say, 10 o'clock in Newfoundland.
Hello, boy, Bobby.
It's true.
And it's always, why not, eh? It's always interesting here. You have a look at Beaupre now causing all this trouble against the Islanders. What a situation that could set up going back to Minnesota. And I do want to say it's very unfortunate for the North Stars. They have played a whale of a hockey game here tonight. And this 6-3 score is no way indicate the way this game has been played.
Can't disagree there. The Stars gave it all they had, but look at this, Bossy again. Oh my goodness, he'll give you fits. Bossy is in front of the net, comes to the line. Lane couldn't get the shot through to him. 3:20 left, it's 6-3 now. And just a little while ago, Gary, it looked as if Minnesota was in great shape. But not now.
Bossy with that goal ties Trottier's playoff record for points at 29. So both line mates have done it in years.
They're going to
see the Ciccarelli and Bossy having a few words. Trottier last year, this year it's Mike Bossy setting an NHL record or tying that record by Mike Bossy.
There they go, wham wham. Maxwell and Bourne, it looks like. Oh. They got back up, so they're going to let him go again. And the rest of them will have to move out.
Well, Bobby Bourne's really been feisty in these playoffs, hasn't he?
It's always bad news when the officials have to get down like that with their hands on the ice and one player is up as he is now. Those skates cut your fingers off so quickly, and you see the officials Stickle and Scampanello trying to get them apart. What's happening in a situation like this, fellas? It's 6-3. Minnesota obviously have written this one off. Here's Bourne getting up. He gets a big hand. They love him here in New York, and they love this kind of play. But as I was saying, they've written this one off. What are they trying to do now? Set the stage for the next game in Minnesota by this muscle work? Is pushing and shoving and fighting or what?
Well, as I mentioned earlier about Beaupre and Trottier, this whole thing started back earlier when he got the stick up in front of the net. And you saw at that time that Trottier went back and gave Beaupre a shove. And, you know, he's a confident youngster in there, and he's probably challenging these guys, and they don't like it at all. But so they're out there to try and prove a point. As you saw when Bossy scored, he went right over to him right away. Something like Ciccarelli and Pat Riggin with Calgary in the semifinals.
There's number 20, Ciccarelli. He'll go into the penalty box. Number 22, Bossy. Two goals tonight. They have a few words.
Bossy is one young man that doesn't want any part of this fighting. He has been quoted many times. He feels there is no part of fighting in a hockey.
There's
look at this now.
Behind, right there. Both lefties. That's interesting, Gary.
Unorthodox, they call it.
Well, Bobby Bourne is not noted for the fisticuffs either, but he handled himself very well. But that's what happens every once in a while. I'm sure the North Stars, the green machine, will be looking forward to getting back to their own stamping grounds and home ice.
Well, you know, they're definitely frustrated. They played a good hockey game. They played well enough to win against any team here tonight. The breaks did not go for them in a lot of ways. The one goal, or we thought was a goal right at the end of the period, the time running out, a few bounces, and, you know, all of a sudden it's a 6-3 game. It's not indicative of the play here tonight. The North Stars have come in and played a whale of a hockey game, and I think they can hold their heads up and go home looking to have that home ice advantage and come back and see what they can do on that home ice.
Well, when you look at it, the Islanders have been able to capitalize on their chances. A couple of key draws by Merrick resulted in two goals, and then that set up by Trottier to Bossy. When the Islanders get the chances, very rarely do they miss. They put them in.
Well, I think things have settled down enough to get it going again. This all happens with 3:16 left in the third period. Islanders with a three-goal lead. Ciccarelli in the penalty box for Minnesota. Lane for New York. And here comes Kallur. Bourne has gone to the dressing room.
And the Islanders looking for their seventh straight victory.
Gary, you were mentioning Minnesota. And, you know, the ability of the Islanders to capitalize in the faceoffs. You know, when you got Minnesota's guys like Young has been hurting, he's a centerman. You've got Bobby Smith has been double shifted throughout the playoffs. He's got to be a tired hockey player. Young Maxwell is up with a bad back up the middle. They really lost a lot of centermen, and it's showing now in the critical faceoffs that the Islanders have been winning.
Especially when you look at the strength that the Islanders are having. When you have a Trottier, a Goring, a Merrick, you know, that's pretty solid center iceman going against you.
Islanders penalty. Number 24, Gord Lane. He gets 10-minute misconduct and a 2-minute minor. Number 14, Bob Bourne, 5 minutes for fighting. Time of all penalty, 16:44. That's Ciccarelli of the North Stars, 2-minute minor, 10-minute misconduct. Maxwell of the North Stars, 5 minutes fighting. Lane of the Islanders, 2 minutes minor, 10-minute misconduct. And Bourne of the Islanders, 5 minutes fighting at 16:44.
3:05 left in the third period of this game. Get a chance here. We'll give you those penalties. It's 6-3, the New York Islanders, and they have this one just about put to bed. 2:50 left. And it's a play to Nystrom. Coming out is Carroll. Nystrom comes through center ice, takes his long shot. Beaupre stopped at the fans. Get on the Minnesota goaltender now. He's been beaten six times by the New York Islanders tonight. Bobby Smith up over the line. He's stopped right there. And again, it's cleared by Morrow to Nystrom. Nystrom puts on the brakes, passes back to Morrow. He'll waste a bit of time. 2:20 left. Langevin coming in. Long shot in on the boards, and Minnesota back regrouping. Coming out is McCarthy. Up to center, McCarthy, being watched by Gillies. Gets away from him. And now 2 minutes left. Minnesota North Stars just shoot it in. Langevin for New York. Back to his own net into the corner, McEwen to Merrick. Out with Gillies on the left. Gillies got the pass up over the line. Gillies shooting. Down as he left that shot go. And it missed the net. They hold it on the boards. And they get a whistle. No further play. The penalties again here at 16:44. Bourne and Maxwell, two majors, for fighting. Ciccarelli, a misconduct and a 2-minute minor. Gord Lane, a misconduct and a minor. So 27 seconds left for the minor penalty. 6-3, Islanders on top of Minnesota. Time running out, a minute 35 left. To center ice. Tipped in by Palmer, he was spun around, knocked down by Gillies. Barry gets set. Pass didn't come to him, and comes over here on the left side to Gillies, now to Barry. Minute 15 left. Langevin, they'll just run the clock out now. Greg Smith coming around the net. 1:05 left. Up to center is Smith. Got across the line. Tries to put a pass through. Just a minute left. And Minnesota will be down 2 games.
Well, a couple of milestones tonight. Actually, individual records. With Trottier breaking Orsmark.
There's Nystrom looking for another goal for his New York team. He's in back of the net. Dumped. Merrick went down also. They still fight for it. Now the referee, Brian Lewis, standing right there, decides that's enough. And he calls the play for a face-off of the Minnesota zone. 37 seconds left.
Well, that's quite an accomplishment for Brian Trottier, scoring a point in 15 consecutive games, breaking Bobby Orr's record. And how about Mike Bossy, equaling Brian Trottier's record of last year, 29 points in a playoff series.
You know, that, at one time, that was almost a good year, 29 points in a season.
Well, they're two great hockey players, and they play very well together. They've been playing together now for 4 years, and you can tell out there, they throw that puck blindly, the player's there, and you just wonder how the heck they do it. But that comes from playing together for such a period of time and being very smart hockey players, both of them.
30 seconds left as Minnesota comes out. On the right side as Anderson didn't get too far. Hartsburg will shoot it in. That's 24 seconds left. That's more about Gord. Mickey Redmond with Gary Dornhofer and yours truly, Bob Cole, here at the Coliseum in New York, the clock winding down. We get ready to leave now for Bloomington right after this game with a charter with the North Stars. And we'll be there for game three Sunday night. This game is over. And the New York Islanders have taken their 2-0 lead in this series. And really, Gary and Mickey, that's not surprising, but Minnesota no doubt will have a different feeling at home.
Shots on goal in the third period. Minnesota 8.
This
the Islanders
is Stanley
16.
Cup 81 for
total
Long Island.
The game. Minnesota 28. The Islanders.
Home light string trimmers really get the job done. Featuring the new lightweight ST80, the rugged heavy-duty ST200, and the ever-popular ST100. And now, HomeLite introduces a new line of electric string trimmers in the ST20, ST40, and ST60, all lightweight and dependable. If you're looking for a gas-powered or electric string trimmer, get a HomeLite and give your lawn the finishing touch.
An official apology from Canadian Tire.
Well, this isn't exactly official. I personally want to apologize for our name, Canadian Tire. That's no name for a store with a sporting goods department like mine. We sell fishing and camping equipment. You see any tires? Daiwa, Coleman, Cooper, do they sound like tire names? So please accept my apology and remember my department. We have brand names and great prices. We have everything except the right name.
There's a lot more to Canadian Tire than tires.
You know, it makes our day when folks come back and say, there's nothing like Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Mmm!
What'll it be this time? Thrift Box Prime. A whole chicken fresh and golden brown. You got to admit, Kentucky Fried Chicken sure is the best chicken in town.
Mmm!
You'll know what we mean the minute you bite it. Kentucky Fried Chicken. There's nothing like it.
Well, the score of Game 2 is the same as for Game 1. The games were hardly the same in any other way because the North Stars played much better, but the Islanders rack up another victory, winning it by a score of 6-3, and the Islanders won the opening game without any points from Potvin or Bossy, and that has to show you something, and of course, you can't hold them off the score sheet for very long. The North Stars didn't tonight. Potvin, the first star, 2 goals and an assist. Star number 3 is Bossy with his 2 goals to tie Trottier's points record, 29, and in between Wayne Merrick with 3 assists, 2 big faceoffs. The North Stars, Don, I think, are down to their last hope, not their last chance yet. That comes if they should go down 3. But the last hope is that home ice can turn this series around. Can it?
Well, I'll tell you something. I think that this last period helped Minnesota. Ciccarelli's in there kicking the heck out of the dressing room. They're mad now. They were going along like sheep led to slaughter. I think this really helped them. I think they're going to come out flying. They're mad now, and they're ready to go. They got their emotion back. You'll see. Glenn will really take he'll take charge now. He'll tell them, look at what they did to us. And I think he's got something to work on now.
The Islanders' physical force, though, is something to behold. And throughout the season, in terms of the standings, nobody was better. And it just seems the North Stars haven't got anything with which to combat that.
Well, they got to get Bobby Smith going. I mean, this guy, he led them all through the playoffs and everything. He hasn't done a thing so far. I think he's going to be picked number one star in Minnesota. I'm making a prediction that he'll start going, and they're not out of it yet. These guys, they got a lot of heart, and they get behind that Minnesota crowd. They go nuts. They're not out of it yet.
You are right about that. The Minnesota crowd, no matter what has happened here, will be very noisy. It'll be interesting to see what happens, but the Islanders are in the driver's seat. Everybody thought they'd be leaving the island. We'll return with Stanley Cup 81 in just a moment.
You don't have to be a genius to change your own oil and filter and save yourself up to $10. Valvoline Motor Oil shows you exactly how quick and easy it is with step-by-step change instructions on the back of Valvoline cans. It's really quite simple once you get the hang of it. Just see for yourself, then do for yourself. No wonder more and more drivers are changing to Valvoline. It's a smart way to save up to 10 bananas without a lot of monkeying around. Right, Val?
This is Polaroid's new Time Zero One Step.
Pretty. Why is it black?
So you'll know it's the Time Zero One Step. And here's the world's fastest developing color. You see it in seconds now, not minutes.
Look at that color. But why a Time Zero One Step?
It comes with a pack of Time Zero Super Color Film in this made-for-each-other pack.
Certainly are made for each other.
Just like coffee and cream.
Rolls and Royce.
Or me and you.
Try ham and cheese.
There are a lot of aircraft on exciting missions in the Canadian Armed Forces and challenging jobs for good people with the regular forces or the reserves, pilots and navigators and others. If you've got what it takes, we've got a great life for you.
There's no life like it. There's no life like it. No,
we're the Canadian Armed Forces. Look for us in the yellow pages under Recruiting.
Sun's coming up, they're biting today. Trolling or cruising, catching your way. Mercury, that's how the world goes fishing.
Mercury's small fishing engine, 9 easy running outboards plus 3 electric thrusters. Featuring the new generation Mercs 3.6, 18, and 25. That's fish power, 3.6 to 40 horsepower.
Mercury, that's how the world goes fishing.
The Minnesota North Stars, down 2 games, have a couple of days now to lick their wounds and contemplate further changes that might work against the New York Islanders. We've talked about the home fans who should give the underdog North Stars the lift, but they know they need more than that. The next game then is Sunday night. Remember, Sunday night for game number 3 of the Stanley Cup Final, and it will be an 8:30 Eastern time start from Bloomington, Minnesota. We look forward to talking to you from the Met Center in Bloomington. Till then, this is Dave Hodge bidding you good night for Hockey Night in Canada. Canadian, the great Canadian breakaway. Canadian General Electric, progress for people since 1882. Canadian Tire Dealers, with 326 stores to serve you across Canada. And by the Ford Motor Company of Canada, on behalf of your Ford and Mercury dealers from coast to coast. This program is protected by copyright and is intended solely for the entertainment and enjoyment of the viewing audience. Reproduction by any means, in whole or in part, without the expressed written permission of Hockey Night in Canada is prohibited.